So we'll go ahead and start the tri-board meeting. It's a few minutes late. We don't yet have somebody here from the Finance Committee, but I think we are expecting somebody.
It's not a tri-board meeting.
So it's a, so the other bi-board. The other bi-board.
Right, was it a prep?
Oh, that's right, it's not a tri-board meeting. It is a preparation meeting for the form.
Just so in case there was a posting problem.
Let's be clear, okay.
Crystal.
So the point of this session, leading up to the 7 o'clock Select Board meeting, was to bring people together to kind of brainstorm the content and the format for the public forum that we've scheduled for next Tuesday, the 13th, to start at 6:30 p.m. And do we have a location now?
It's over at Hopkins Academy.
It will be at Hopkins Academy, okay.
And the department heads have been notified that they should be there as resource people.
Okay, excellent.
For 6:30?
6:30, right. And I had a brief conversation with Jennifer today, just kind of brainstorming through, obviously it's short notice to get this advertised, but something we'll want to make sure is in the Gazette and do everything we can to get it on TV, HPAD if possible, Facebook.
Mass Live.
Mass Live if possible, sure, we can call Diane Letterman. With the goal being to get as many folks there as possible who are interested in hearing about the state of affairs in Hadley, leading up to the fall town meeting. So, David, I know you did some work pulling together some financial information, and I think, based on the conversation we just had, that these are ideas, but not intending that each one of these slides would find its way to the presentation, but maybe we could all talk through what we think are the most relevant pieces of information for folks to hear about.
Sure. So taking the SWOT analysis as the general guide of, we're a small town and we enjoy our small town feel. We are dealing with service delivery issues of a much larger town. I often say that Hadley is a town of 5,000 people, and that's true from about 2 a.m. to 5 a.m. The rest of the time there are 20,000 people or more in town, and we have to be providing those services with the resources of a small town. I also appreciate that Hadley has a small town feel to it. Most people know Hadley from the viewpoint of Route 9, but most of us know it from the viewpoint of the bike path. So taking some of the things about that were illuminated during the SWOT analysis, we do a million things right. We have very strong finances. We have good cooperation among the departments. We provide excellent services. We have a low tax rate. We have a well-balanced tax base. We are a leader in renewable energy in the county. Nobody comes close to us. We've preserved more open space farmland than anybody else in the Commonwealth. So there are a lot of things that we do right. There are weaknesses, however. One of the things that came up in all the SWOT analysis was bench strength. You know, how many staff do we have to provide the services that we do provide? And what happens when you have to add services? What happens when somebody retires? What happens when somebody is away on vacation? Related to that is our succession planning, which we are doing a better job of now, but we still need to improve. There's productivity issues. There's limit on our new growth based upon restricted zoning. There are the usual problems of not enough revenues to meet the ever-increasing expenses, including the unfunded mandates that constantly seem to pop up. So with that in mind, illuminating both what we do right and what we need to focus in on so that we can do better in the future, we worked together to come up with 26 slides, which we're not proposing that we show these 26 slides on Tuesday, but tonight is just a sample of how we can look at show Hadley to the points that we want to convey and which ones are the most salient points that we want to convey so that we get the message across clearly and effectively. So in front of you is a series of PowerPoints as well as Excel spreadsheets. Pages 1 through 10 focus in on revenues and fund balances and contains a lot of information that we lovingly took from the Department of Revenue site. And pages 11 through 15 talk a lot about our debt profile and particular kind of debt capacity that we can assume in the future. And then pages 16 through 26 talk a lot about expenses and break it down into major categories of expenditures, so general government, public safety, education, and provide trend analysis for all of those. So you have revenues, you have debt, you have expenditures contained within this draft document.
And just to be really clear, the formatting is not, this was just to bring the information in front of everybody tonight to talk through. Obviously, this is not the most
compelling,
right, a PowerPoint, but we would then, you know, work on the formatting to make it more appropriate to tell the story that we think needs to be told.
I have to be honest, I laughed at the 26 slides because when Linda and I started discussing the points of the school department, we were at 15 slides and I said, that's way too many, I think 3 is enough. So Linda argued that 3 might be too few, but so perhaps you were right.
But then she sent it back to me and it was 16.
That's true.
As an initial phase.
So, I mean, just in terms of how the format for this might work, was thinking that we would have, you know, kind of just brief opening remarks and then maybe go into a higher level, well, just hit the highlights of the SWOT analysis. So to David's point, you know, talk about and maybe have a few slides about Hadley's strengths, things that are going really well. You know, I don't see any need to start out on any sort of negative front. But reminding all of us that there are an awful lot of really good things that are going on around here. And maybe even some of the financial slides can be, like, talk about stabilization. You know, we have a strong stabilization account and the like. And then, you know, then get into the challenges side of it, right, that were identified in the SWOT analysis. And then, you know, maybe that's the time for kind of key financial, you know, the basics, you know, here's what we have in our savings account, so to speak, here's where the revenue comes from. Because this is supposed to be a public forum. I mean, there are probably plenty of people out there who know this really well from going to every town meeting for so many years, but there are many other people that may be new to it and don't really know how our tax base splits and that kind of thing. You know, so I think some of those pretty basic slides are worthwhile,
mm-hmm.
you know, on the revenue side. And then on the expense side, understanding where, how that pie is split. And then maybe some of the trends, David, mm-hmm. like from those departmental ones, the latter part of this 26 pages, that trend analysis, but just the trend graph,
mm-hmm.
you know, public safety, school education, I think it is, public safety, education, general government. I know, what do you guys think?
I think it's one of what we have.
Yeah, that is basically the approach we took. An introductory slide, here's what the schools are, a quick snapshot,
mm-hmm.
here's expenses, revenues, how the budget works, 5-year forecast.
Where we're heading, right.
And then a summary.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But I think we assumed that Annie and I assumed we should assume that the people in the audience don't know much and
right.
don't know how, even what the schools are and how the school budget works.
Right. Yeah, I think that's right.
There's a lot of different parts to it that people
exactly.
don't know.
Right. And so at some point in there would be a carve out for the schools to do, you know.
Well, that may, I kind of assumed it was kind of every department doing that, but I would like the schools to have a carve-out since we're such a big part of the budget.
Yeah.
And the budget works so differently.
Yeah, and I think we agreed at the last meeting, we were talking about no more than 45 minutes of presentation.
Oh, yeah.
So ideally...
Total.
For
everything.
Yes.
Ms. Keegan, did you hear? I want 3 slides. That's a lot of talking per slide. Okay, everybody.
7 minutes. But that we would do a carve-out because, again, the schools, like Joyce just said, too, I mean, it's complicated. It doesn't operate the same way that the rest of the town does, and maybe helping people understand the funding and...
Yeah, the funding. You've got your grants, and you've got all of this other, and...
70.
No, it just makes...
Are you going to field questions in between, or are you going to field questions at the end?
At the end.
At the end, I think.
Okay.
Then you may want to consider shortening that presentation to 35 minutes, because you start losing people at number 36.
Okay,
yeah.
I mean, to the extent we can keep it to that, and then really allow for...
You mean the whole presentation, 36 minutes, at the school?
No.
Everybody?
Yeah.
Well, I thought we were having a 2-hour time frame.
Right, we're allowing for an hour and a half to 2 hours.
Right.
So it was going to start at 6:30, we should wrap it up by 8:30, I would assume, somewhere in that area. But I don't think that 25 or 35 minutes is very much when you have a lot of departments that you're going to want to at least present some form or another of what's going on with them. That's kind of hard. I think you can just, if you have an hour to answer questions, I think that's good. I think an hour for presentation is minimal for what we have to tell people. I mean, it can give or take a little bit, you know.
You can have a long, I agree with David that if it's just chart after chart after chart and numers and data, you will lose people after 35 minutes.
I think they just want the basics.
Yeah.
We don't have to get into the nitty gritty, just say, this is what the school funding is, and just, you know, give them bullets. You know, this is the bullet thing. And then at the end, if they have questions on any of those bullets, then they can ask them.
Well, and I think where the departments come in would be in the form of bullets. So let's say David has this slide, the 5-year trend analysis for general government.
Mm-hmm.
But then a slide would follow that could be right out of the SWOT analyses that were done, that, you know, we all kind of agreed that there were certain common themes, so we don't need to get into every single one, but we could talk about infrastructure, you know,
mm-hmm.
the information technology piece, human resources, GIS, I mean, the things that were
the
highlights.
The police, the fire, I mean, all of those.
And then do another slide for public safety, and then the police and fire would follow the
mm-hmm.
bullets. So to your point, it's not numbers, numbers, numbers.
And while those people would be available and at the meeting, they would not necessarily be presenting. They'd be more fielding
questions
regarding their
yeah.
departments.
And I was wondering, when we get into at the end, so let's say we are holding for questions, and then at the end we get into the... you know, hopefully there are people there who are asking questions, whether that should be moderated in some way. And I was trying to think of anybody that had any sort of experience in that regard that could moderate the question and answer period. That might have been...
Anybody ask Brian?
Trained.
Yeah, I thought we talked about asking Brian.
I'm just thinking Jerry's been town moderator before. So.
That limits my ability to speak as a selectman.
Oh, no, it doesn't. You have effort, you control the mic.
Oh, I'd be happy to do it.
It enhances
your presentation, and then you can control the mic. It's all you.
Yep.
You just have to have some set rules, and that's all.
Okay.
So much per question or 5-minute, you know, things that you want people not to take up a whole hour with one question.
Mm-hmm.
You can only talk so much about the budget. This is what we've got, this is what we can spend, and hopefully this is where it's going.
Mm-hmm. And then should we also have one that's a buildings update? Like just from...
They should be.
You know.
In the presentation?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, talk about the recommendations from the Municipal Building Committee, because they did that report.
Mm-hmm.
And then again, the challenges of timing, plan,
Are you envisioning at the end of this that you'll be posing your question of your own in order to get feedback from the town as to where strategically you want to take the town in the next 5 years?
I don't think we're planning on that, were we?
I don't know, because if we hit dead air, nobody's asking questions that provoke any conversation, we should probably want to provoke, right?
We can, but we're gonna have our town meeting pre-meeting as well. We don't want to overlap those two.
No.
That's what I want to make sure that we don't do with that.
That certainly depends on who shows up. We've had forums before where we haven't had good attendance at different times, and you know, again, it all depends on who's there. You can have the whole room filled with town employees and or who's going to speak or could speak or could answer, but you actually need to have bodies of, you know, concerned citizens that this is what it's being held for. It's not being held for us, it's being held for other people.
Right.
I think this is more of a state of the union. This is where we are, this is where we're heading, this is what we have for opportunities, this is where we have for shortcomings. This is, you know, what the budget issues that we face on an annual basis, and you know, here's the nuts and bolts of what's going on in your government. So.
Linda?
I agree that you have to touch on the capital items and the buildings. My concern is that so many of the capital items, we've had petitions, we have a lot of emotional feelings about buildings. I would hate to have that overshadow the budget. And I would want to make sure that you kept a real clear distinction that the budget issues are not competing with the buildings, that you've got a capital that is subject to, you want to vote it in and you want the override, we will fund that separately. That won't affect the budget. But the budget is something that I think has gotten a bit of short shrift with all of our capital issues. So I just want to make sure that they stay separate and that you give enough attention to the budget, because there are a lot of concerns in that area.
Yeah, that's a good point. And so that, I think those need to be clear talking points when we're going through those financial slides, the operating slides, reminding people about, here's the funding mechanism, you know.
Right.
They're separate issues. So do we want to, did you have an idea of what you wanted to present? Looks like you brought some stuff with you.
Just that overview I gave. We're not done. Because it's 16 slides long, our hope would get, we're hoping for 10-ish, 10 to 12-ish. And so looking through, but it will be
just
that.
But they can still be all bullets. You can have 10 slides and this is what's.
Talking points.
Talking
right.
points.
Sure.
And that's perfectly fine. I mean, you're not going to limit to what you want to get out there. That's up to your department.
I think we need to understand that there's going to be an audience other than the people that are there as well, too. If we're going to videotape this, you know, people are going to use this as a resource, too, for the rest of the things we're trying to do. So let's not just focus on the people that are there. I know a lot of times people are busy and don't want to come out at night, but we'll be happy to sit in the living room and watch it. So.
So do we want to walk through these and just kind of agree on what we think?
Well, there's not much to agree on with the growth and the tax and the classification. And so what else you have?
On page number 5, this is labeled tax by classification. It's actually valuation by tax classification. How much is your residential and open space worth versus your commercial, industrial, personal property?
Yep.
So
say that again, David. I can't read those words. Residential and open space, and what's the other one?
Commercial.
So it's basically the tax base is often bifurcated into two parts.
Personal property.
Okay.
One would be residential, agricultural. And then there's your CIP, the commercial, industrial, personal property. And this is not tax revenue, this is valuation. So one of the nice things about this slide shows a very, very healthy balance between CIP and residential.
Mm-hmm.
That's what makes Hadley work very, very well, is that balance. Everything in life is about balance.
Really?
We do it so well.
Are we going to have one of those slides in there?
Yeah, we'll have
the teeter totter.
So, to that, what Annie and I were trying to do is, if we had a chart like this, we were trying to add a text box at the bottom that basically was like, this is what this slide is saying.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
So what you just said is the perfect little thing.
Yeah.
We have
right.
a healthy balance,
yeah.
and balance is important.
All right, we'll let him put that in there. You know one that's not in here, I'm wondering if it would be worth having a slide for? Maybe not, but I'm just thinking, one of the things that people are aware of is our bond rating.
Mm-hmm.
So would it be worth having one like timeline that shows the bond rating like 10 years ago? You know, because we've actually gotten
to the state. You could do that with stabilization.
But the bond rating is easy because we can just clip that from my budget document. That can come straight out of there.
I think Molly's talking about 10 years ago versus today. I think she's doing an analysis to try to tell.
That's right, with stabilization.
Yeah. Could we make one of these
slide,
out of it?
Sure.
Then it can be a slide. Yeah, and well, it could be on stabilization, but that's just a piece of it.
It's a piece of it, but it's what drives it. What our stabilization account is certainly makes it a point of
it's
where
a, it's a piece.
So
we could put it in a text box.
So 11 years ago, when I started out, it was A plus, and now it's double A plus. So it's gone
right.
through four or five.
Mm-hmm.
Upgrades since we've been here.
Right.
That'll be an easy one, as well as one on the tax rate, just to show how we line up with other towns in the area.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of stable.
Yeah.
Right.
And then do we want to...
Let's use like communities and not infuriate people with particular highlights.
Why would it be? Do we want to then just make this pie chart bigger? That's the one with the expenses.
Right. I think that would be very helpful.
And then not, you know, we could have the numbers handy, but not on a.
That's page number 8.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We'll do the same for 8 and 9.
Then you get the debt capacity.
Yep.
I would put those two up front.
Debt capacity?
No, the 8 and 9.
Right.
Because that's, to me, the overall picture.
Mm-hmm.
Here's our expenses, here's our revenues, here's where we are.
You could say here's the revenue, here's where your money's going.
Right.
Right. Okay.
Debt capacity, we talk about this stuff all the time, so in levies and debt capacities, but it's not as easy a topic for people to understand that are just listening to the topic. So I think we need to make sure that people understand we have things coming off the levy. This is our debt capacity. This is how a strong community grows in the direction, and why you would want to grow in that direction.
There's a great, I'm picturing it, and I'm trying to remember if it's in the, I don't know if it's at the DLS or the Department of Revenue, but there's a page that talks about the levy system, the system, yeah, how it works. And there's a really good graphic picture that shows...
Healthy versus...
Yeah, well, yeah, and a 2.5, Prop 2.5 and stuff. Can you...
Yeah, that probably comes from
the manual?
Proposition 2.5 levy primer.
That's what it is.
Yeah,
yeah, there's... And so maybe we could borrow that for a slide. And so to your point, and then be able to explain it.
Why you'd want to grow like that and why it should grow like that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how healthy communities are.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So do we want to have the sewer and...
I think those are speaking points, but I don't think they're...
They're slide worthy.
I don't think they're slide worthy.
Slide worthy, that's an expression.
Just what their enterprises are, because I think that's what
But you go back to the stabilization and the bond rating, and I think, you know, what DOR is asking us to maintain,
mm-hmm.
and that it's maintained, and that's how it reflects on the bond rating, I think mm-hmm. is, I think that's simple stuff to understand.
Mm-hmm. I'll take those out. I don't know that we want to get into inflation adjustment.
I don't think so either.
Uncollected property taxes, I mean, whether that's a bullet or a slide, but I think it's good for people to know what a good job everybody does paying,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, the town does collecting. Expenditures per capita?
Yeah,
it's a blended instrument.
But I think the expenditures by function, the general government, and like I said, then that's where we could hit the highlights from the SWOT analyses,
mm-hmm.
follow it with a... So that's really the next... And we could put water and do we want to put water and sewer in there, or ignore?
I would use it as a highlight when we speak to
okay.
bond ratings.
Okay. Okay. Take the enterprise ones out.
Of course, these only go up to 2014.
Yeah, we don't have the 15 audit yet.
Mm.
It's overdue. So one of the things I was thinking as the last slide on would be a number of resources that are already on the website that people can go to. So if they want a compendium of all of our financial policies, those are available already on www.hadleyma.org.
So if you're a wonk and you rent the rest of the information, it's available.
If you want to look at our audits, they're available.
Okay.
There's a number of financial policies and information that's available, as well as the Massachusetts Department of Revenue website, which is also a wealth of information.
Mm-hmm. But is this where you have human resources here, or human services, so that would be the senior center. Are they going to do a presentation that night? I know Suzanne's coming in this evening.
Right, so at the department head meeting, based upon the instructions you gave me, that the department heads should be available at this hearing, but this is really your hearing,
mm-hmm.
and that they're not doing presentations in and of themselves,
okay.
But they're there as resource people, so I told them not to prepare anything, but be prepared for anything.
So if we
that's very good. That's my opening remarks next year at the start of school, David. I like that.
But I would imagine so to that point, maybe we're, you know, walking through a
mm-hmm.
slide. But it would also be perfectly reasonable to then turn to Suzanne and say, you know, would you like to comment any further on that to give her the opportunity to clarify if she wants or?
Absolutely.
No.
Unstructured questions like that will,
mm.
you know, you'll go so far off schedule and time.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point.
But they would be available after, should
yeah,
you
right,
continue
right,
the conversation
right.
privately.
Yeah. Yeah. I also just want to be respectful of the department heads and make sure that to the extent anything is said that they may be like, whoa, you know,
yeah.
that didn't come up from me. They're listening too, so they may pick up on something. So I think we need to be conscious of watching so that if it looks like maybe something needs to be clarified, that we give people the opportunity to do that
yeah,
for the
so,
experts.
So take, for example, slide number 22. There's a big step up.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. So somebody may ask a very reasonable question of why the increase.
Mm-hmm.
And the answer is that's when we stepped up our game with respect to veterans' benefits.
Mm-hmm.
We actually started providing them
right.
holistically.
Right.
So that incurred a cost.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, we have more seniors in town than you know, besides veterans. I think it, that helps the rise of that number also.
Yeah, but that's really driven by veterans' benefits. That particular.
So, in terms of format then, so again, if we have, you know, opening remarks and then the kind of the overview SWOT analysis, maybe David's best situated to do that overview.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then, much like town meeting, maybe we could divvy up the slides as long as everybody has talking points. You know, maybe one person goes through a few. Obviously, the school's going to do their own, but. And then turn it over to the next person. So again, it's not just monotone, one person going through everything.
I don't mind you doing it all. I mean, because we don't even have the slides yet as to what it's going to be wet down to. In between now and Tuesday, it's going to be hard for.
But that's what I'm saying. If there are talking points like we have, I mean, most of this stuff is stuff we've already heard before. I mean, so I don't think anybody would be
uncomfortable yeah.
or having to ad lib. But if we have bullets and you're just walking through the bullets.
Okay, so how many do you feel we'd be down to slides in the end?
Well, how many do you have?
We are going to have 10. Is that how many we're going to have?
We're single digit.
So we'll have more than that.
Yeah, we'll probably have like 20. 15 to 20, I would think.
26 here, we're not having
26. No, I'm sorry. Somewhere between 15 and 20, I think we're going to land based on what we just talked about.
Okay, all right. So we'll wop up something tomorrow, we'll circulate it around us, and you know, we'll have the weekend to tighten things up.
Yeah.
All right.
Anyway, we have a lot of work to do on the prettying this up.
Mm-hmm.
Any other thoughts? You comfortable with that, John?
Yeah, that's fine. I think in the end, we just need a number on what it's going to cost, you know, not just a percentage. Like,
well,
per thousand, what it's going to cost taxpayers if we go up on whatever we're going to raise the rate.
Oh, to give them a sense of
yeah.
if the town borrows $1 million over
yeah.
X period,
yeah.
it has this impact.
Yeah, for X amount of years or whatever, that
yeah,
has to be in there.
Dan,
we need that answer.
Dan has the.
Yeah, Dan will be on hand and he'll have that information.
I think we
have to be careful about some of the nuances that. The question, it seems like a very simple question, but when you put it into the dynamic mix of a falling debt service rate as well as the other kinds of variables that are in flux, we can talk about this is how much of a tax rate this may represent,
mm-hmm.
but I think it would be very difficult for us to say this is how much your taxes are going to be going up by.
Oh, no. Yeah, we can't
so
do that.
I think we will eventually get to that point. But I don't know that that's on Tuesday.
That's not this
one. I think that Tuesday is here's our opening salvo and the condition of the town.
Yeah.
And then we work with the community, like what do we want the town to be and where do we want
right.
to go? And
we've been talking about it for two or three meetings to put a number on it. We need
right.
to put a number on it and
yeah.
present it to the people. That,
right. But maybe not
and I was against that from the beginning, but the financial situation
well, it might
we're
be
in,
before
we
town
that.
Meeting, that meeting that we're having.
Oh, maybe.
The 20th before town meeting?
Yes.
Well, at that meeting, we can talk about anything that's on the
warrant.
But,
which is
but
the,
this is a bigger picture.
Right.
This is, a you know, looking out over the next 3 to 5 years,
mm-hmm.
you know, what's that going to be looking like? And I think to Linda's point, that would seem to be part two. This is the introductory forum just to get people comfortable with the idea of a forum
mm-hmm.
for this purpose. And then the next one, John, you know, would
yeah.
be, okay, you know, we've got all these challenges, kind of gave you the background, here's where we're at, and that one would be more maybe eliciting of input from the community.
Yeah. You know, because if, you know, once we get into buildings, it's gonna be a percentage every year, and it's gonna affect this 5-year plan quite a bit, whatever the people decide, so.
So the opening remarks, I'll assume that that's a select board chair, correct? And then SWOT analysis, the overview of data, select board's presentation of slides, and then you expect the school department to have their slides ready after that. And then it opens up to Q and A.
Yeah, and I would think we may just insert the schools when in the midst of the other departments, and then there'd be maybe some follow-up after that, depending on how these lay out, so.
Do you
or you can go right at the end, yeah.
Do you want to go at the end, or you want to go in the middle?
I don't have particularly strong thoughts about that. I suppose we could just give them to you so they're formatted similarly.
When you're working, when
when is
what's
he
your
not
time
working
here, David?
Okay, so we have meetings all next tomorrow morning, so it'll be the tomorrow afternoon that we would be putting this together in broad brush strokes. With an outline of what we're going to be talking about, a series of slides, some mock-up slides, and then we'll start putting that together in closer to final form on Friday.
All right. So why don't we look at when we'll look at the first draft, and then why don't we all have a email with David too, so as not to violate any laws, where we think schools should go in. Once we've had a look-see.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. And what I can do is I'd be happy to bullet out just the opening remarks, and then I can just, again, just disseminate that.
Okay. Sounds good. Hopefully we'll.
Okay. Yeah, hopefully.
Tell your friends.
This budget is going to have a total of what it's going to cost on the tax, or is there going to be override, or is there enough money to cover it?
No, not for this forum.
Yeah.
The Tuesday forum is intended to be just an educational forum for how things work, where we stand today. It's not intended to be, we're recommending a budget, and this is what the impact on your taxes is going to be, because we're not there yet, so.
I hope when you get to that point, as you go through, this is what's going to cost us on our taxes, not everybody going to sit there and figure out what this would cost them on their tax.
Right.
But
right.
That won't be on Tuesday.
Yeah.
No.
When we get to the warrant article run through on October 20th, we would have all of that cost information when people are voting, for sure.
20th of October.
Yes, October 20th, not September.
But this presentation goes far beyond
exactly.
The special town meeting.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right. This is the overarching.
Right.
This is an informative information
yeah.
about town government, how it works, where the money
right.
goes to. And this is the State of the Union. That's all this is. It's not,
yeah.
there's no budgets, there's no overrides,
yeah.
there's no nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Just the explanation of the budget and the cost for communities.
Okay, so anything else on the prep for the forum?
Nope.
Nope.
That's good.
Okay, so everybody will work collectively and independently to get the word out.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully we get some people there.
That's good.
Okay.
Good.
All right. Thank you.
Welcome.
That was nice.
Done early. See you next week.
I put out for TV or whatever.
I know, whatever it is.
I don't really know.
Right. So we're ready to move into the select board meeting?
Can
we?
We're posted for 7.
Are we posted for 7?
No, you're posted for 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
And all you are legally responsible to do is post the agenda. What order you want to take it on the agenda
yeah.
is up to you.
Here.
What did you say?
Yeah, so let's go. We can probably do Mass Highway if they're ready.
People
see
it humming.
Oh, to hear.
So
yeah,
that?
That's true. That's not as an appointment.
You know, because it involves Route 9. There were
yeah.
some people that were interest in whether they show or not, I'm not sure, but.
But, yeah, it's an appointment.
Okay.
I think because it was posted for 7:20, we should maybe keep them, we can do the other stuff.
We can get going.
Consent agenda.
Yep.
By everybody.
All the new business.
Okay, so let's roll into the consent agenda.
All right, I think we need Jennifer to guide us through a couple of things here.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, so just reading off the consent agenda, and then Jennifer, you wanna chime in at the end, or? Okay. So we have the August 17th and August 31st minutes for approval. We have warrants 10-11 and 9-S. We have a one-day liquor license for the top of the campus slated for October 29th. We have another one-day liquor license for the Western Mass Climbers Coalition. And we have a liquor license change of manager for Chipotle.
So moved.
Second.
Can I?
Discussion.
Please. I would like to ask for the Western Mass Climbers one-day liquor license. I would like to ask that y'all put approval with based on additional conditions from the fire chief.
Okay.
It's already been through the police chief.
It has been seen by the police chief and approved by him.
Mm-hmm.
There was 100 to 150 people, and they're not certain the location. It's based on weather. And so we wanted to give Chief Spankbabel the opportunity to voice any other requirements that he would like from them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so is that understood as conditioned? Okay, so all in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's see. Town Administrator's Report. David, do you want to? We skipped over this past couple of weeks, so
right.
Want to hit the highlights?
I'm on vacation.
Well, thank you very much for allowing me to catch up with family and with friends. And this is the wrong folder.
Did you say allowing you to? We're a kinder, gentler select board than that, David.
So I very much appreciate you allowing me to catch up with family and friends. I've been in Sacramento, California, and Sandwich, Massachusetts, and I'm thankful for everybody's help in making the town run smoothly in my absence. So it's been a while since I've presented my town administrator's report. Here is the report for September 7th, and this will be posted online. I'll just touch on some of the highlights. The Bay Road Bridge, environmental, the design is complete. It's now up to environmental review. Mr. Warner and I had a conversation about this. It looks like this environmental review is going to take some time. So I think we're stuck with a bridge which is going to be down to one lane for some time, and I can't tell you how long that's going to be.
Meaning through the winter?
Potentially.
Yeah, great.
And it's got to go out to Army Corps of Engineers,
mm-hmm.
and then they say it's a 3-month project once it commences. So
mm-hmm.
It was unclear what I heard today whether they were going to work through the winter on it or not. I happened to get a phone call from MassDOT on another subject, and so I got the information out of the senior bridge engineer before I gave my information. So,
okay.
But that's basically where they're telling us they're at on it. So
the
so
thing
they,
that kills
when are they
me.
Starting?
Excuse me.
When are they starting?
He would not commit to a day because it's still the final design's done. It's got to go out to environmental and then off to Army Corps of Engineers. So that timeline, we don't know how long that takes.
So who's going to plow that bridge this winter?
I would assume we will be plowing it like we did last winter with a small vehicle.
I think she's heading for what vehicle you're going to use.
Yeah.
I think we should bring them in. You know, first this was a temporary fix.
Yeah.
Then they said it was going to be done by August.
Then they said,
they
oh,
haven't really
that.
Came in and explained anything to us of what they're doing at all.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're getting some information to the DPW director, but the board, they made a presentation to this board and to the public. And I want them in here, and I want them to answer the questions.
The ones that are here now aren't involved in any of this, right?
No, I wouldn't think so.
Too bad.
So the ones The ones that are outside are here for the next issue, which is the Route 9 widening project. Mr. Warner can expand on this, but basically the water portion of this is done. So now it's 100% a Mass DOT project associated with widening the road. The project has gone very well from our perspective in terms of the water work, not so well for some of the neighbors who have to put up with the noise, vibrations, and dust. ETNL, the contractor, did help out the University of Massachusetts by shutting down on Friday, the 2nd of September, when the students were coming back in. So MassDOT is here tonight in order to talk about the next projects. The first of those projects is a roundabout at the western part of Coolidge Bridge, and that is scheduled for 2018. And then in 2020, the next phase of widening Route 9 will occur from the Farm Museum all the way to the intersection of East Street. We have an opportunity to replace aging sewer lines and water lines in that right-of-way, so we're going to try to partner with MassDOT in order to accomplish that. We'll also be ramping up, and that's in the capital budget. We'll be ramping up for those before too long. 2020 is only a few short years away. I think it's safe to say that this current project has saved the Hadley water ratepayers at least $150,000, perhaps more. And we'll have a tally of that at the end of the project. So this is an opportunity we very much want to jump on board. The public safety complex HVAC control project, that work is nearing completion. Public safety complex roof update, the bids were received on August 29th, and tonight I'll be asking the board to award a bid. It appears that the apparent low bidder is $20,000 above our available budget. We have a building maintenance fund which has a balance of $92,000 and change. The municipal building committee has earmarked $47,000 from this fund for other projects, which leaves a balance of roughly $45,000 for this purpose. So if we transfer $31,250, we'll be able to fund this project as well as provide for a 5% contingency. So I'll be asking for that vote tonight. Land request proposals for sale of land to the town in the center of Hadley. We received two bids. Those bids were clarified, ranked in order of responsiveness to the RFP, and are going to be presented to you tonight. Owner's project manager, the notice to proceed has been sent. The OPM firm has been employed, and we're trying to coordinate our schedules for a kickoff meeting. And the OPM will start working with the Council on Aging and the North Hadley Fire Substation Ad Hoc Committee. Commonwealth Compact, I had expected to hear from the Department of Revenue by now, and I'm going to, tomorrow morning, send them an email and say, where are we with our two projects? Those two projects are a financial management team feasibility study and two, a safe route to schools project. So this is important. I've also talked to them about an IT program, and that deadline for that, the opening of that opportunity is going to be coming up in September, so we're going to submit an application for that. The electricity aggregation project, the public notice period has concluded. Good Energy will submit Hadley's electricity aggregation plan to the Massachusetts Department of Public Utilities. And once DPU gives their approval, then Good Energy will conduct a bid process for electric rates. Assuming a favorable outcome of the bid process, Hadley residential electricity users should start seeing a discount on their electricity bills, and I'll be bringing that to the board when it's appropriate. Capital plan, the capital committee is planning to meet on Monday, and they'll start reviewing the capital requests as well as the five-year capital plan in time for the October 27th town meeting. state of the town, we just talked about that at length. Stormwater permit, Marlo and I are going to continue to get training on that, and we'll coordinate that with the town departments. Public records law update, we had a big department head meeting this morning in order to talk about how we can position the town to best comply with the new requirements of the public records law, which should take effect in January 2017. And then the same with the Municipal Modernization Act update, a wide-ranging overhaul of many municipal laws signed into law by the governor on August 9th and will help improve cities and towns' performance on their functions more effectively and efficiently. We will be bringing new things to the town, and we're going to be getting as much training on this as possible. Just to pause for a moment, I've been doing this work for 21 years, and I have never seen such a wide range of helpful legislation come out as this one act did. And so I've asked the department heads to get as much training as they can on this issue, because there's a lot of benefits, there's a lot of value to the town of Hadley, and we want to extract as much from this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity as we can. So we'll be seeing stuff on the special town meeting warrant associated with this, and we'll be working with the treasurer's office for some articles for the annual town meeting. But I just don't want people to underestimate how important and how helpful this particular act is. And then we have tomorrow's state primary from 7 to 8 p.m., 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. Registered voters are encouraged to turn out and vote. That's over at Hopkins Academy. Then this weekend on Sunday.
And the times are?
7 a.m. to 8 p.m.
Mm-hmm. People like to know that before they go to work in the morning?
Absolutely. This Sunday on the 11th, there are two events. There's Chicken to Go, as I understand,
mm-hmm.
and
Region.
There's a polka festival over at the Council on Aging. We have a public forum on Hadley's budget coming up on September 13th, 6:30 p.m., Hopkins Academy. Fire Association Chicken Barbecue, September 16th at the Arnold's Club. Wine Tasting and Tunes at the Council on Aging, September 22nd. We have a special town meeting coming up October 27th, as well as a preview of the warrant articles on October 20th. And there we are. Any questions
for David?
Yeah, I was reading somewhere, there going to be grant money or some kind of funding available for that stormwater permit?
Yes.
Have you been checking into that?
Yes, so we've been working with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission in order to look into some sort of assistance there. There are two kinds of assistance, three kinds of assistance that we could be pursuing. There's grant money for some of the initial startup. There's the regional effort of coordinating the municipal response to the stormwater permit requirements, so that not each town is not spending effort reinventing the wheel. We just take one model that can be applied regionally. And then there's opportunities through technical assistance if we regionalize our approach, so that we may save some money that way. Particularly in the area of bylaw development, in the area of coordination with other towns, as well as making sure that our applications are uniform across a wide range of towns, because nobody wants to be an outlier on this one. Everybody wants to be marching in the same direction, the same pace.
Pioneer Valley's going to kind of take care of the three counties right here right now? Or?
Right, so they're working with the communities that are affected by the MS4 permit. To the best of my knowledge, there are no communities in Franklin County that are affected, so it's all Hampton and Hampshire counties at this point. There are Berkshire County communities, there are Worcester County communities, but PVPC wouldn't be directly involved in them, but they are communicating as regional planning agencies.
Do you know if the whole town is affected by this or just sectional? Would you know that?
It's basically the Route 9 corridor.
Route 9 area, right?
Just north and areas and south, and then the the Lake Warner.
Lake Warner.
Region.
Anywhere where there's water, basically.
Correct.
Around there, that's how they adhere it, okay.
And to that end, Ms. Keegan and I met with the Chancellor of the University of Massachusetts to talk about a coordinated response from UMass and Hadley with respect to issues of drainage waters, because we receive a lot of our drainage water, particularly to Lake Warner, from the University of Massachusetts. So we're tied at the hip on this one.
Are there different ways to attack it in our aquifer also? Is that part of it?
No, it's just stormwater.
It's just stormwater.
But I mean, if somebody builds in the aquifer area, I'm sure they would have to adhere to these rules and regulations, right?
Well, as this permit goes on, I'm just getting used to the first 5 years of it, but as the permit goes on, it affects building and building permits and so much stormwater runoff from a property when you build on site, so much stormwater retention you have to keep on the property rather than runoff. So there's like 152 parts to this.
So eventually we might be in the same situation as Northampton, where impervious material, you're being taxed extra when you put more impervious material on your property?
Well, that would be something the town would need to adopt. That would be, like, I suppose, like another enterprise fund in order to fund the MS4 permit,
yeah.
which is another way. The other way is an SRF loan. Mm-hmm. But I think the question was the fund, the grant. And,
yeah.
Right.
And,
it was either in a Beacon or somewhere they were talking about it. Or maybe it was in a waterworks.
Yeah, I saw it somewhere.
I saw it somewhere, so yeah. It has to have been something fairly public. Yeah.
Yeah, so we've applied for the SRF funding. We should find out in the next couple of weeks whether we were successful in our application. In terms of setting up some sort of charge for people separate from either your taxes or your water sewer bill, we haven't even begun to explore what that may look like or if we're willing to do that.
Okay. Anything else for David on his report? Okay. All right. So it's 7 o'clock, so let's jump back to public comment. Is there anyone here for public comment period today? And if not,
yeah.
John? Yeah.
We got that hearing in front of the ZBA the 19th. Where is the board stand on this substation in North Hadley? Is there, can I say, the majority that would support this? Non-majority?
So it's public comment, John, so we can't, that would be deliberating and discussing. So, and I think the position of the select board was that we wanted to hear what the ZBA okay, so before we have a 7:15 appointment, so our 7:15 appointment can go, or we should probably wait though, because in case people want to.
Are you expecting anybody else?
No.
Oh, okay. Would you like to go then?
Sure.
All right. Welcome.
Thank you. Very quick. Just wanted to let you all know that things are kind of waiting for trying to have conversations with the OPM. So I'm sure we'll talk at some point to know where that's at the Municipal Building Committee meeting. I was told last night that they probably would be calling me sometime in the next week or so to try and ascertain what next steps would be on my end insofar as getting them whatever they needed to be able to work off of those things to have a true working meeting so as to make the best of any time spent together during a meeting. So we're waiting on that. And also I've been asked by quite a few seniors if they were going to have to wait as long as they did during the meeting, because a lot of them don't like to drive at night. They want to make sure they're going to get there. And they asked me to inquire and see if it would be
possible in deference to those people, if we could have it earlier in the meeting rather than later. I did just today see that it was for right now in this draft, article number 8, and that's great if we can keep it somewhere close to that. They would be much appreciative of that. That's what I have to say about that. So anything that we could do to help them get here and get home safely. We also will be offering rides like we did for the town meeting. So just any seniors out there, if you do need a ride to town meeting on the 27th, we're also having a potluck on the 13th. We're also, or the, yes, the 13th and the 20th for the town forum discussion. So there'll be ample opportunities to get more information or answer any questions, and hopefully we might have a little bit more information to give them at that time if we've been able to coordinate getting together with the OPM. And I do want to remind everybody that Eddie Foreman is going to be at the Senior Center on Sunday, this coming Sunday, and that'll be from 1 to 5, and he'll be playing from 2 to 4, and it's free, and you can bring lawn chairs and come and enjoy.
So thanks for sharing the information. Questions for Susan?
Yeah, I
Donald?
Just want to make one comment.
Mm-hmm.
The article in the paper was very good, but it was sort of misleading with the hole in the wall. Nothing was explained. It seemed like the whole building had holes in it. The reason why that hole is there, it has knob and tube wiring in there, and it cannot be covered by law. It would have been repaired a long time ago. I asked the building inspector, and that was the answer he gave me. That's the reason why you see that hole there and it's open.
If that were our only issue, we'd be golden. Yes.
David?
Since you're both here, you're both petitioners for this warrant. I received news this afternoon that this clerk certified all three petitions.
Thank you.
Good. Anything else for Suzanne? And certainly we'll take the feedback from the seniors into consideration when we're going through the articles.
Much appreciated.
Okay. All right. No? You good?
Great.
Okay.
Thank you so
Thanks,
much
Suzanne.
For coming.
So.
8-1, can we get on that?
Pardon?
8-1, we have one in the back.
I don't understand what you're saying. Yeah, we're, their appointment is at 7. Oh, that's what you're referring. Yes, that's where I was going next. So under new business, we have a discussion about the DPW director and the treasurer. Both want to discuss signing authority. So anybody want to go first?
Go ahead. They're different.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, since I've been here for about 6 months, obviously I've been getting reacclimated to this form of government as mayoral form in Greenfield. So trying to learn the ins and outs of who signs what and, you know, what comes to the board. And I think I've said to David numerous times, I don't want to step on anybody's toes. You know, I'll make sure paperwork's going in the right direction and being signed by the appropriate people. So my question was, there's a lot of in-house MOUs, permit, single-year contracts, and renewals of contracts that a few of them, or some of them, I think one of them came up last week, was the Franklin County Solid Waste District that everyone signed. And I wanted to ask the board in a sense of streamlining some of this paperwork that goes up the ladder and down the ladder, that I wanted to clarify and ask on some of these things what, as the DPW director, that I can have the signing authority for to help streamline some of these things, the in-house stuff that I had just mentioned, the NEPI's permit, stuff like that. But I wanted to talk to the board about it because of the form of government. I'm not sure, as the commissioners, where that authority will lie with me as the DPW director.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think anything legally obligating the town, we typically want to come in front of the select board,
yeah.
Right? So legal, we can come in front of the select board. Now, with the select board's approval, can someone else execute that contract with their signature? Sure, right. if we delegate that authority. But it would seem like a lot of the internal stuff, I mean, I'm certainly for streamlining, especially David's office in particular. I mean, because everything that it's going from Marlowe to you, to here, to you, and back to Marlowe, right? So, I mean, are there things that the two of you have talked about that you want
to... I have the authority to sign things on behalf of the board as chief procurement officer. That's one of your bylaws.
Right.
Marlowe has been good in bringing me everything, and if I think it's something that you're interested in, I'll bring it up to your attention. If it's a purchase order for something that requires a signature and you've already approved it, and we're just going through yet another piece of paper, I'm happy enough to sign it at any time. I think that's what Marlowe is asking for his department, is the ability to sign on behalf of the select board for routine items that affect his department and his department only. Certainly a contract for a construction project would come to the board.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly anything that would
bind... Change orders or anything like that.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I wasn't referring to the procurement. I mean,
right.
I talk with David daily about
mm-hmm.
procurement and
mm-hmm.
running forms through them and the applications
mm-hmm.
and stuff. But it's the everyday business mm-hmm. stuff that
right.
I've seen floating up the chain and down the chain.
Yeah, and I would think that we could if the board chooses, execute a specific delegation of authority document that would be specific as to what we're saying, yeah, go ahead and do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like that's how they do it in banking. You can delegate,
right.
you know, okay, this person can approve a loan up to $25,000 or something like that. So,
you know, as far as the big ticket items, just the one you just particularly pointed out was the sewer one. You know, and that's with Franklin County COG. And you know, we went through a lot to get that deal done at the time, I remember. And there's the little glitches with Franklin County right now with the cost of it. But, you know, once it went out to bid, I guess it came back fairly reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
Not what we were paying at all, but it's a big ticket item that should come in front of the board. I want to see what those figures are, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Referring to the sludge?
Anything. I mean, you just put $25,000 amount on it. I mean.
Oh, no, I was just saying as an example.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No. It was,
yeah.
I was referring to the MOU for the solid waste certificate. It's
yeah.
a $500 a year annual fee,
yeah.
and they help
yeah.
us maintain
but
our
But the actual
pricing.
Contract and stuff like that, you know, that came in front of the board last week.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean,
yes.
That's not where I was going with this.
Those are big ticket
yeah,
items
absolutely.
That we need to see
mm-hmm.
because that's going to affect the operating budget
right.
that we're already having trouble with, you know?
Yeah. But I think, you know, part of the reason that we formed the DPW and that we have a DPW director is recognizing that, you know, having a separate commission and the town administrator handling, you know, being up to their elbows in all of the day-to-day operations didn't make sense. So I'd be happy to support a formal delegation of authority, but I think just from an internal control standpoint, we want to make sure that delegation is clear so that we don't run into a situation where you said, oh, I thought you meant I could sign, you
right.
know. And
I mean, I can decipher also. I mean, if there's any doubt, obviously, I would bring it to David's attention or meet with him on it.
And I think we would like a list of what he has signed,
yeah.
just for knowledge.
When, as it happens?
Yeah.
Sure.
I mean, you know, at our meetings, just our point of information or something of things that have...
Or like the
that
in-house
you feel
things.
Like we need to, in-house things that we
Is
need
to Is it okay
to
send it up the chain with the email and then...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, if you want me to come in and... I mean, that's fine.
Yeah, I mean, I think we should move towards streamlining as much as possible and not spend the board's time dealing with some of these not that your job is mundane in any way, I didn't mean that, but, you know, more routine... Routine matters, just like you're saying.
I think David understands our feelings regarding this so that he and Marla can
yeah.
work on on a protocol and bring it before us again so that we can be. And we don't need to reinvent the wheel in communities where there's select boards. I think you can reach out, figure that out, and find some type of protocol and bring it to us.
Like an example is the vehicle maintenance software that I'm about to enter an agreement with JJ Keller.
Mm-hmm.
It's you know, $2,500 a year to cover 60 vehicles, which is minor money, but it's things like that. I mean, I try and keep the board updated on my goals and objectives as they're going forward. Sometimes I feel like I over communicate, but I'd rather do that than not communicate. But a lot of that stuff I send out via email. You should be getting an email at the end of the week as an update on a lot of things that are happening at the DPW right now. So.
Yeah, we don't want to be a bottleneck.
It's things like that.
I think we already voted for that in the past. We accepted it, right? To do that?
The goals and objectives.
Yeah, so it'd be just
now I'm down to nuts and bolts.
Natural,
and
but
money
I think in a short period of time, you're going to be coming in with probably restructuring of your department because of the resignation of Mr. Kowalski. However you're going to treat it, we don't know. So you will be having much more discussion of how the responsibility of management will operate in the DPW in the future, I think.
Okay.
So you'll work with David on that and then
absolutely.
Bring it back?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all right, that sounds good. And Linda, you have part
yes,
B to this?
This is about streamlining too, but nothing you haven't been doing already. Back in May, I think this was for the summer, you as a board voted and signed a sort of a permission that David have the authority to sign off on the vendor warrants so that we could get the bills paid and out the door on Fridays. A part of that was because the summer meeting schedule and the various things that were coming up and I think at the time, not knowing how that you even have as many meetings as you did this summer, because typically you don't have that many meetings in the summer. And rather than wait until the entire board, or at least a majority of the board, can sign off on the vendor warrant so that we can pay the bills, you on May 11th signed something, giving David that authority, which expired on August 31. And so as of now, we again will need the majority of the board for the vendor warrants. And I'd like to request, I'd like to see how you felt that worked, but if it worked well, it worked well for on our end, and we would like to see that continue. And the reason is that we are finding that there is a quicker turnaround needed between when we receive bills and when they're due than it used to be. And by the time a bill gets to a department head and they authorize it and they find the account number and they send it up to the accountant's office and it gets onto the vendor warrant, so you've got the department head has reviewed the bill, then the accountant's reviewing the bill to make sure it's in the right information and coming out of the right place, and they assemble the vendor warrant, and then it goes down and it gets the select board signature, and then it comes up to us and we actually send out the bills. In order to shorten the turnaround time, the accountant has been accepting bills to go on this week's warrant right up until Tuesday morning when he's here. So it gets assembled on Tuesday. If you're meeting Wednesday night, as I think you probably signed something this evening, the warrant was finished yesterday, you signed it tonight, and we will get the bills out of the treasurer's office on Friday. If you were not meeting tonight, we would either be having to send out the bills next week or be calling you and say, please stop by and may go down and see Jennifer like by the end of Thursday or Friday morning. Do you have a majority yet? Do you have a majority yet? And then calling and saying, who can come up? Can John come up? Can you sign all these? We've scrambled a few times in the past. This would be the exact week, and I want you to understand it's not because we're delaying anything.
You sure? You sure? Because I never remember this being a problem before, and now all of a sudden we're
really
in trouble.
Isn't. I mean, she's called me, what, maybe three times?
Okay.
You know?
All right. Well, let me tell you, last Friday we received the veterans information to make the veterans payments. And generally, we make the payments on the first Friday of the month. We can't receive them until the month is over and it gets into September. So we didn't receive them until Friday morning. We need them to go out this Friday. We already are receiving calls from people wondering where their checks are. So if you're saying it's not a problem to come in and sign, that's fine. I'm not. If that's what you're agreeable to, that's all right.
I think everybody's sitting down there right now.
You know, and you remember town meeting, I think that was the very one, I'm going up and down the row there, saying, please sign this, we can get the veterans' payments out.
Is it specifically theirs?
That's once a month. There's also the contract payments that we often need to get out. We try and get them paid right away. As soon as, when we pay the contractor for out on Route 9, then they've got the money to pay the town for the private duty police officers. And then we receive the income, and then we have the money in which to pay the payroll to the private duty police officers. And we can't pay the police officers until we receive that payment. So there's it's a bit cyclical in some of these items that we need to get our payments out so that we can, so that they can pay their bills, so that we can pay our officers.
I actually don't have a problem with it being used as a last resort to it when there is instances where you're getting things on Friday and have to have something out on Monday. I mean, I understand that, but...
But not every week.
No.
Okay.
No, not as a... So if we need a motion in order to allow it in under
we
certain
circumstances...
We need
to do our job for being elected to this position, so I don't see why we can't come in and sign. You know, summertime, I understand. We're on, you know, everybody's on vacation and doing whatever they're doing.
Yeah, I mean, I think on an exception basis, I'm fine with it, but... But yeah, I mean, the buck stops with
us. I stepped in on a Thursday morning and signed it on my way to work or whatever. I don't have a problem signing it.
Okay. All right, because I know it was at least two or three times where I send out emails to all of you, and I feel, you know, I feel bad saying, especially if I saw you during the day and something had came up and I needed to stop back in again. But if you're saying you're fine with that.
I got the message when our check came 2 weeks late. I got the message.
You figured it out, huh?
Yeah. That was easy.
I understand this is, we're only talking about vendor warrants, and I think you know we get out the payroll anyway.
But I still think we should be able to have that flexibility that if something happens and it's either Molly or David that signs it, it's perfectly fine. I mean, I think we already, there was no stop and sign, oh, it expires on August 31st, so why don't we just renew that
for exceptions.
I'll make a motion to renew that, signing rights to Molly, the chair, and or David Nixon, whoever is available for you, for certain, whatever you need, and certain things that come up where we're not available. Something comes up after we've already signed on a Thursday, you need it to go out on Friday, please use them as our backup.
Second.
But don't make a habit of it.
We always do collect all the signatures on
yeah.
it. So, and I have to say, in the 3 months that we were doing it, I never came back to us that a bill had not, you know, that a select board member went to sign it and say, how did this get away from us? Why did this happen? Mm-hmm. So it seemed to me that it was working well.
Well, it was a little confusing when he was coming every 2 weeks or.
Yeah, I think part of that was the transition.
Yeah.
Yep. So we have a motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Yep. Okay.
Is there an expiration on that one, or is this
forever and ever?
Yeah. All right. All right.
That
thank
wasn't
you.
Part of the motion.
Okay. So we do have a 7:20 appointment with the Department of Transportation. So you folks want to?
Yeah, sure. Let me just assemble my team.
Sure. Thanks, Linda.
I can fire the deck.
I'm going to get right up in up front and close and personal with you guys.
Oh,
I don't know if that's going to interfere with the projection. That's the only question.
Oh, it may.
I may move the screen a bit.
Whatever works for you.
If I may just back up a bit. Brought a big crowd.
I was going to say, it's an illustrious crowd.
Well, we were expecting a larger crowd here, but I know we typically have a good audience on TV, so at home. So.
And you just took up all the seats anyway.
So. I know, right? Well, like, I forget, I'm not sure who the department head or committee person was that you were referring to earlier, but you guys were talking about some content. It was, I can prepare a presentation, but be prepared for anything.
Right.
We have both, so.
Short and sweet.
That may not work.
It's awful big.
I think you just need to move the table much closer.
Yep. If people don't mind, I would.
No.
If you have power.
Yes, we do. We're the way through the set.
You didn't bring any popcorn?
No, we didn't bring any popcorn.
I knew you messed up somewhere.
That's a great idea.
I was going to say, it's not too late for me to order pizza.
Okay, so that looks good. I think that's fine. The light's fine.
Yeah.
Okay. We've come before you guys a couple times. I'm Michael Trepanier with MassDOT. I'm with our headquarters. I'm a project manager in Boston. I've come with my colleague Rich Massey, who's the project development engineer out of the District 2 office in Northampton, here in the Valley, and a team of experts that have been working on the project for the last 2 years or so. Carolyn Radich, Jason DeGray, and John Sorio from our design team, and actually the newest hire to MassDOT, my assistant Mark Kotowski, who replaced Mark Kolonoski. You may remember him.
Still got the skis going.
We got the skis going. I mean, you know, we gotta follow along. Gotta follow the right lead, right? So anyway, I will try and be brief because I really do want to spend as much time giving you guys an overview of what the technical team has done. But ultimately, what we want to discuss is, you know, where we've come from, where we're going, and quickly give an overview of the transit study that we conducted for the B43 route. Since the last time I was before this board, we found out from a number of stakeholders, including the PBTA, PBPC, other local officials, the city of Northampton, and Amherst, and UMass. We brought all those folks together to discuss our project and what the best outcomes and goals for the projects are. But ultimately, what we're really talking about are two projects that have these primary goals: to increase safety for all modes. And I'm getting ahead of myself. As a reminder, the project area is for physical construction that we'll be discussing is from where this project here leaves off all the way to Maple South Maple Street intersection. So going all the way along that commercial corridor. And picking up where we've left off with these improvements ongoing today. So we recognize that the corridor right now functions not so great for vehicles and really not so great for everybody else. So we want to increase safety for all modes, relieve some of the congestion that we're experiencing, especially at the intersections at East Street, by the malls. Provide these improvements, but ensuring that we're sensitive to the unique character of Hadley. And really equipping Route 9 for the future, making it fully accessible, making it multimodal. We've conducted this long-term study for, as I said, the B43 route, looking at how to improve its operations, really capitalize on the number of buses that are out there and get those buses flowing freer and quicker to really help draw off some of the single occupancy vehicles that are traveling along the vehicle that otherwise could shift to that mode, and ultimately do what you're seeing out front right now. Reconstruct the roadway, rehabilitate the existing pavement, upgrade the drainage, widen the roadway, and improve and add a bit of capacity. So like I said, we essentially have two projects in one. The first was what we originally came here before this body to discuss, which was, you know, widen the corridor. How do we do that most efficiently to move people throughout the corridor? All the way from the big anchors at either end, with Hadley right here in the middle, between, you know, Northampton Center and UMass and Hadley Center, right smack in the middle of that, alleviate congestion, and consider, what does that mean? How do we do that for the long term? How do we build for the future without building another massive highway like, you know, the 116 segment that you see, you know, where it intersects with Route 9. So we're really trying to avoid doing that because we don't think that is really sensitive to, obviously, to the context here. What we found, especially after consulting with a lot of folks from town employees here, people who have been involved in our stakeholder group, Donald, thank you for joining us a couple months back over the summer. We heard that, you know what, in order to really get that vehicular capacity out of the corridor, you got to improve the bus route and get more people on that bus get the students off the corridor and get them on the bus. So we've done this much larger scale transit mobility study that isn't limited to just the piece of the corridor we want to reconstruct. It's really looking at how that operates, how the route operates, where are the passengers picking up and getting off, and really digging into that and analyzing it. So I won't steal your thunder, Carolyn.
No, that's fine.
I'll leave you all that stuff. So then the real big question was, if we've got those improvements and we take into account other factors like safety and private property impacts, we really need four lanes like what we have further down the corridor and starting right up front here. As I said, this has been a long ongoing process. We first met with that larger stakeholder group in July 2015. We had a special subcommittee of the folks that were really interested in how to analyze the transit work and give us some direction and guidance on what to look at, how to look at it, what some of the goals for that study were. We had our first large scale, auditorium scale public information meeting at the Academy in September, just under a year ago. And we've done some targeted briefings like this with the Pioneer Valley chapter of Mass Bike. They were really interested in talking to us about improving connections to the Norwalk Rail Trail and things like that. And then we had another second stakeholder meeting once we had come to some conclusions in analyzing the various alternatives back in July, and now here we are tonight. We were invited to come present before the board so that we could give not only the board an opportunity to see what we've done, but also the community as a whole for those that are joining us from home. So with that, as I said, I'm not very good at being brief usually, so I hope I have. Carolyn, I'll turn it over to you to discuss the outcome of the Transit Mobility Center.
Very good, thank you. In terms of building on the goals that Michael's talking about, we want to get more people using transit. We know how to do that. We need to make the buses go faster. So, less time wasted in congestion and other delays of inefficient routing, and more attractive waiting areas, and signal prioritization. So we're looking at a different type of service than is here now. This is bus rapid transit, or BRT, and that is a host of improvements on bus lines like this one that we can implement to make the transit more effective and to attract ridership, which is our ultimate goal. So some of the characteristics of what we're calling BRT light in this area includes the buses traveling with cars in what's called mixed flow lanes. So there's a range of BRT to the gold standard, which is like basically rail transit on wheels where they have their own dedicated right-of-way, no cars. We obviously don't have space for that here, and so we're looking at the buses in with the traffic flow. Traffic signal priority for the transit services. So this is a big item that we can do to decrease delays at the signals and to make the bus service more effective. So that's another feature of BRT that we're looking at here. Stop consolidation, we'll look at removing some of the stops that are not heavily used right now, and that also reduces delay for the buses. Typically, BRT, you're looking at a quarter to half mile spacing on stops, and again, that makes just the service work better and go faster. Improved waiting areas, you can see an image here, just a nice shelter from the rain, and just a more comfortable place to wait for the bus. Real-time travel information, so that's saying the next bus comes in 5 minutes. And with rapid changes in technology, you can have that as an app on the phone. And that really is a comfort to transit riders, and they can feel more comfortable riding the bus. Another thing that they do is branding of the buses, so the buses look a little different than the sort of regular bus routes that you have there, so people visually understand the BRT lines. And ultimately more frequent service, and that's really our goal, is to have service that's more timely and also more frequent. So in looking at the B43 line,
just as an overview, basically it goes from Smith College in Northampton through Hadley, serves the malls, Haggis Mall at UMass, and it goes down to Amherst College in Amherst. So that's the current routing right now. Just to give you an order of magnitude in terms of ridership, about 20% of the boards and alights are in the downtown Northampton stops. About 15% of the boards and alights are at the malls. And in fact, the Hampshire Mall is the second busiest stop on the entire line. So that several hundred riders a day going through there on and off the buses. And the very busiest stop, about 20% of the ridership is at the Haggis Mall stop at UMass, and you have another 15% of, through the town of Amherst itself. So, you know, the stops in between are lesser, but those are the big sort of what we call anchor points along the line.
It's hard to determine what the ridership will be, though, if you haven't made the improvements yet, correct?
That we're going to project, we can project ridership. So we're going to do a model, and I'll get to that at the end here, of how we would change the route, kind of based on what we know, and then we'll be projecting, we'll have more better time information for how long it takes, and then that helps us understand what the impacts on ridership will be.
Do the express runs that are instituted today, do they have any stops in between Smith College and UMass?
The express runs? I don't think so.
No, we don't think so.
And it's a very quick route when they go through. For them, the time element isn't very long at all.
Yes, because they're not
stopping,
you know,
additional
stops. Stopping along the way, exactly. And also, you know, in some places for the regular fixed route ridership, they have to meet a schedule because the schedule has to be predictable for people. So sometimes they wait at a stop, like at the mall stop. So an express bus doesn't have to do that. So we looked at planning considerations in the basic areas and communities along the route. I'm not going to go into all of them here tonight with you. We want to look at delay and figure out how we can reduce delay. And we identified, you know, the primary areas where we're getting delay. The biggest one is at Damon Road, particularly westbound in the evening, as you well know. Going over the Coolidge Bridge, and ultimately as a part of a separate project that intersection will be improved with a roundabout. That's going to help the Route 9 movement, so that will help that delay somewhat in the bus routing as well as for cars, and that will be factored into the modeling. So a lot of the other delays occur with stop signals, so we can address that through signal priority. Also, getting through Northampton and Amherst downtown, where there are a lot of signals, a lot of pedestrians crossing the road, that does cause some delay as well. You know, pedestrians also use transit, and that's more attractive, so that type of delay is a positive thing. But, you know, again, Northampton has some ideas for their main street that would reconfigure the road, that would make the crossing distances shorter for pedestrians and would also help the signal timing. So we think that will also help the transit service delay in those areas. Just in terms of the Hadley area, in central Hadley or old Hadley here, it's lower transit usage, so it's a much lower density area than Northampton and Amherst and UMass, so we would expect that. There's 4% of the boards and lights are on the seven stop pairs on that segment. Part of the issue is also that it's very difficult for pedestrians, and transit riders are pedestrians before they get on the bus and after they get on the bus. So, you know, when you use the bus, you have to get off on one side of the street, you have to be able to cross to the other side to get on the bus to go in the other direction. So, you know, the pedestrian environment is very important in thinking about improving ridership. Middle Street, for example, in this central part of Hadley has the highest usage, that stop pair. You know, you can cross the street there with a signal and their sidewalk. So I don't think that that's, you know, a coincidence. I think that that is because there's better pedestrian amenities at that stop. At the malls, as I mentioned before, there's a lot of traffic at those malls, and so we're very interested in how we can make that more effective. Signal priorities is not working real well there. That can be tuned up. That's a technological fix. But again, we have a situation with difficult pedestrian conditions, being able to cross the road. You know, all those riders that get off at the Hampshire Mall have to cross the road to get on and ride back. So if that can be safer, more attractive, and also the waiting environment more attractive, you know, to the extent we could do that, we're going to attract transit ridership. So just to summarize, after, and we've looked at a lot of other factors as well, what we are recommending for the changes to the B43 route is to basically have a mixed flow system. We're looking at rerouting the route. So instead of going up University Drive to go up Route 116, we think we can save time through there. There's not heavy ridership at the stops on University Drive. Transit signal priority system-wide. So now we've got three different systems. Northampton has one system. Hadley signals have another system. Through Amherst, they don't have any signal prioritization at all. Rerouting, a part of the reroute that we're recommending is to terminate this route at UMass, at the Haggis Mall, and not go down into Amherst. We'll save a lot of time. PVTA thinks we could save up to 40 minutes there. There are a lot of other transit routes that serve Amherst and connect to UMass, so those riders are still served, but not by the B43. So that's gonna be a big savings in time that can allow us to have more frequent service and faster service. We're going to take out some of the lower use stops, and some of those would be in the Hadley area. There's stops there that have very, very low usage. Again, you know, it's a lower density area, but also it's very difficult to cross the road. So to sort of focus some of the stops and provide better amenities would be part of what we would do. So that would be better stops where people can cross the road, but fewer stops. Some of the stops we want to ultimately move curbside. So the ones at the malls, we would like to be curbside because, again, it's more effective for the buses. It saves time if they go through. Just like rail transit, they go straight through as opposed to going out and around, which wastes time.
Which ones are going to be taken out? Let's get a little more specific on this so we can begin to understand what's going on. Please.
I have to look those up.
I'm actually looking to see, as I'm sitting here, I'm Googling to see if we've put this figure on our website, because we're showing you this figure here. You probably can't even read that from there, but this is our conceptual route plan. This is really more of a, you know, the background talking point, but when you can zoom in and out on it as a PDF, or if you get a larger print format, you can get a much closer, a better idea of, sorry to interrupt you, Carolyn, but a much better idea of what the symbol, the symbolism that Carolyn has used here, in that this symbol is a stop that's going to remain. That's a yellow with a black line. The red the symbol that's yellow circle with a red line is stops to be removed or consolidated, and then the blue dot are stops that have been relocated. So there's one stop right about
that's
here.
Elmwood.
And then here at.
It looks like nine stops on Route 9 are going to be eliminated.
No, so there's only two on Route 9 in that central area.
Yeah.
These two stops are stops that go, the bus goes into the mall parking lot.
So we're just moving those out curbside in the ultimate plan. Yeah.
And then these four, are these pairs here?
Yeah, they're pairs.
So these are really only two more stops that... This is based on boarding and alighting, as Carolyn puts it, people getting off the bus.
Pairs means east and westbound.
East and westbound, yes, okay. Yes.
I got another question before you get any further.
Yeah. Okay.
You're quite aware of the crossing in the center of town.
Yes.
And we have asked about the West Street Common, the two sidewalks that were taken out when you widen the road over there. The same problem we're going to have at East Street. It's the same distance from the bike path and from those houses to those bus stops at West Street, at Middle Street, and at East Street.
Yep.
Right.
And there needs to be crosswalks. cars at those streets.
So you remember from early on in the presentation, I said, one of the things we want to accomplish with this is increase safety for all modes. And so, you know, I'll be, admittedly, MassDOT, formerly Mass Highway, you know, there was a different sort of focus 15, 20 years ago, even 5, 10 years ago. Things have been evolving quite a bit.
Traffic is what they were doing.
That was what it was about. Yeah. We were the highway department.
Yeah.
And, you know, we have a very different culture when it comes to how we develop products and then design them. So
right.
I can assure you, East Street will have sidewalks and crosswalks so that it's safe for pedestrians to cross the road there. I mean, I've stood there myself trying to get a sense of that intersection, and it's like, you just, you know, you hope for the red and you pray for no one, for whoever's taking that right turn to see you. I mean, I'm a transportation planner. I'll walk 20 feet up the, you know, I won't cross right at the turn. I'll walk up the road a little bit. But yeah, that's absolutely something that would not be left out. And West Street, I agree. We've been hearing this a lot, and I think that's something that, you know, we can discuss.
It's a dangerous corner.
And even our own members said bring pictures. Well, I do have pictures now of what was existing there at the time. I finally found them. So they were removed, and they were there originally.
We do have a preliminary plan to add crosswalks there, east and west of the West Street intersection, with pedestrian hybrid beacons, which would, person would press the button and the light would turn red for traffic on Route 9.
Do you know they travel 40 to 50 miles an hour through this area?
We
coming
saw
down,
it on the way
they
in.
They come over the bridge.
Right.
I mean, it's like the Indy 500.
Yeah. Yeah.
So these would be actual red lights that would come on for the Route 9 traffic when a pedestrian wants to cross Route 9.
So how's that going to work with a fast line bus?
Well, when
well, it's only there.
Maybe another stop that
so
the bus has to make.
Oh my God!
So,
is this
but
all driven by PVTA?
No.
Is what driven by PVTA?
The transit study. No.
Transit
study. Actually, it was
but
shocking.
But they ultimately will provide the service.
Yes, it was shocking for us. Not shocking, but it was very revealing the first time we met with that larger group. Like I said, that included just about every important player we could find out here who would have a stake or some sort of, you know, some sort of valuable input for the decisions we were trying to make. And this is, you know, this is how we like, you know, this is how we do things now. We don't just make decisions in a vacuum anymore, present them and say, isn't this great? We like, especially for a project of this size and scope, it makes sense for us to start with a clean slate and say, all right, guys, everybody who has an interest, everyone from PVTA, to the Planning Commission, lots of representation from the town.
You know, I agree with the bikes too, because the bikes come down the bike path and they come down to the restaurants and the
and we need to provide that local connectivity for them.
It's not only the people walking on the sidewalks, but the bicycles are crossing there also, you know.
Right. Yeah.
I'm inclined to agree with John. When the bike path is closed during the winter, you still have the ridership on Route 9.
Exactly.
And our police have had a major problem with bicycles riding in the middle of the drive lane, you know, and trying to get them off. And when you reconstruct this, are there going to be painted lanes for bicycles?
So that's something that Jason's going to talk about. So I know you guys, we had a short time on the agenda. I'm psyched to see this kind of feedback and these questions, because, you know, we're the worst thing we want is for you, it's everything to fall flat. You guys, thank you for coming in, get out. But so I want to try and let's move through here, because we have the answers to these questions.
Give me just one more second to
finish
my thought. Is I'm glad that everything's going to move faster, but I'm a very concerned that the people of Hadley are going to be shorted with the amount of stops that are going to end up on there. When we're trying to provide a better opportunity for people to get on a bus, 29% of the population in Hadley works at the University of Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
This is a great opportunity, but I don't want to see the baby thrown out with the bathwater.
And senior citizens too.
And senior citizens as well. So that while we're moving through quicker, getting people to places better, let's remember that there's Hadley in the middle too.
That's
so we don't eliminate most of the stops in Hadley and turn into a thoroughfare.
Just a couple. We're very mindful of that.
Thank you.
Because we want more people to be on the bus.
No, I mean, you're definitely opened up since our last meeting. You've gotten input from everybody else. So, you know, I'm sure with a little fine-tuning, we can all come together. Some
part of the reason for those stops to be eliminated is because the count data from PVTA. They, you know, they have sensors at the bus doors that tell them that, you know, we don't just guess, we know how many people, and we have trends of data about how many people are using those stops, and they're very, very minor, but represent a pretty substantial benefit for the overall operations of the service.
Except you're building a better mousetrap now, so if the mousetrap is better and it's more available and people choose to want to use it, and we've eliminated stops.
So that's something that we'll be modeling, okay, right? That's a metric that we can use to measure whether or not those stops do grow, given that the improvements having been made.
So why don't you go ahead and just go through your presentation, and then we'll hold questions
okay.
until you're through.
All right. I mean, it's
okay.
your meeting. You know, I mean, we want to be respectful to you. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Here, Jason, why don't you have a seat here, and you can take my chair for a moment.
So good evening, everybody. My name is Jason DeGray. I am a New England Regional Engineering Director of the Tool Design Group, and we specialize in non-vehicular transportation, transit. You know, we try to fill the gap between the vehicular transportation modeling and then the multimodal modeling. So I want to set the stage a little bit for what I'm here to talk to you about. Amongst all of this, there's a physical construction project that DOT would like to take on along Route 9 between Middle Street, picking up on the limits of what's occurring out in front of us today, all the way through to South and North Maple Street. This project is an outgrowth of essentially what was recommended when MassDOT studied a potential additional bridge crossing of the Connecticut River. So there's a lot of history here. I think Carolyn and I could probably write a dissertation about all the ins and outs of the socioeconomic and cultural components of Northampton, Hadley, Amherst, and everything in between. But what comes out of that study was a pretty strong recommendation that the environmental impacts of another bridge crossing in the Connecticut River, you know, rule out the preclude the impossibility to do it.
So there's going to be no South End Bridge or North End Bridge.
Right. Since 2004.
So. It's funny you said, I'm actually grew up in Agawam, so I know.
Yeah, I was confused on that.
The recommendation that came out of that study said two things. It said three things, really. The primary objective is that Route 9 is going to carry the mobility needs of the region, you know, for the foreseeable future. And they made two recommendations on how to improve that. One was to investigate the possibility of bus rapid transit, which is part of the reason why we did this study. And the other is to develop a consistent cross-section along Route 9 and to address the segment in Hadley that is currently two lanes where the rest of it is four lanes. So when this project came about, we stepped back and we looked at the volumes and figured out what was going on. It quickly becomes apparent to anybody who knows the corridor that traffic volumes along Route 9 are at the upper limit of what a road of this type can carry. So to take the next incremental step forward, we have some pretty fundamental choices to make. The traffic volumes get to about 25,000 vehicles per day at the given location. That is essentially the upper limit of what a, you know, arterial road of this type can carry. So to go forward and talk about how we encourage additional mobility, moving people along the corridor, we're going to have to be very smart in the decisions we make. We could easily make a consistent four-lane cross-section, which is something we're about to talk about. But even that is only going to get us to so far. To get beyond that, now we're talking about choices that are really impactful, that are really going along the lines of an interstate limited access highway or some other improvements that will really change the character and nature of the region, and not a choice I think we're really looking to make. So we did two things. We said, okay, what is the future of bus rapid transit for the corridor, which is why we took on the planning study. The planning study is giving us the information we need to make a firm decision about what is the future cross-section of the construction project along Route 9 that's going right through the center of Hadley, again, from Middle Street to Maple Street. We want to provide a recommendation as to what that section should look like. We need, in part, to know what the future of transit mobility is. And then we also need to look at this section in its own right and determine what we think is the best possibility. So what is going to happen? Again, planning study is exactly what that is. It's a planning study that's going to make recommendations for the future. The planning study essentially ends there. The physical roadway construction project is shovels in the ground. This is going to happen. The components of the planning study that kind of overlay on top of our corridor will be integrated in as part of the project. Beyond that, outside the limits of the construction project, the planning study is guidance for the future, and stakeholders can advance that as they see fit. What are we going to do? Well, there will be some level of widening along Route 9. We're going to talk in a little bit more detail about what that is. Outside of that, pavement, drainage, signage, ADA compliance, pedestrian, bicycle enhancements, integrated transit improvements, these are all going to be components of this project. So what does that mean? This should be a two-lane existing cross-section at the Central Rock Street Gym. This is the segment.
We always miss one, Jason. We always miss one.
So this is the segment, or one of the key components of the corridor. I'm going to speak to you a little bit in idealized terms about a cross-section. Are we talking two lanes, four lanes, three lanes? There's obviously some nuance to that. When you approach a traffic signal, you have storage lanes for turning movement, so we're not really talking about what happens at the signals. We're talking about kind of the idealized cross-section in between different signalized locations along the corridor. So what we have now, Route 9 for the Central Rock Street Gym, it's two lanes. We're going to widen it, and the two basic alternatives are a four-lane section, which this represents. You see the white building here, that's what this is over here. Four-lane cross-section, similar to the rest of the segments of Route 9. In addition, sidewalk improvements on both sides, the striped bike lanes at a minimum along both sides. That is one alternative that we are considering. The other alternative is what we typically refer to as a road diet section, which is you widen for a third lane. Now, third lane serves for the left turns for either direction. You can do this in a way where it doesn't necessarily have to be the oncoming left turns. You basically look where your driveways are, provide the left turns where necessary. If you have locations where there are no driveways and need for left turns, you can actually put a landscape island in the center, unify the area. In addition to what these three lanes are, we would also again have the dedicated bike lanes and the sidewalks and the other components of the project. So those are the two basic fundamental choices we have before us at the moment. This is again just the same exercise in front of the Hadley CrossFit, or three lanes. So when we step back from this, we make our decision. We're going to make our decision primarily based on two factors, safety and mobility. We're going to start here with safety. This is a map indicating all the crashes which occurred along Route 9 between 2009 and 2013. And we broke this into three distinct segments. The first segment when you come over the Calvin Coolidge Bridge, which is four lanes. The segment from East Street up to approaching South Maple, which is the segment that we're looking at to reconstruct, and then the segment that includes the South Maple Street intersection up to 116 and beyond, which is again a four-lane section.
That's divided too.
It is divided, yes. So we did a safety analysis which looks at the number of crashes that occur along the corridor, and it's a crash rate. It's based on the amount of traffic that occurs. So we can weigh different segments of road against each other and see where there are safety concerns. And the one thing that really stands out here is these two existing four-lane segments have crash rates higher than the state average, whereas the two-lane section has a crash rate lower than the state average. And that tells us that there's something fundamental in the choice between four and two lanes that creates some safety concerns, and we can go into why that is. So that's one piece of information that's very keen to know. This is a heat map of those crash locations along Route 9, the red being the highest incident of occurrence. No surprise to me, South Maple Street and West Street are your, you know, really jump out, and there's, you know, lesser, you know, significant areas along the way. I'm going to skip over that one and go back to it. So now we're talking about why is that. Well, now we're looking at four versus three. And a four-lane undivided roadway has significant safety concerns, and I think this has been a evolution of the understanding of transportation practice, particularly in the last 10 years, where we've really come to know that these four-lane roadways create some significant safety concerns. The primary thing is there's no real uniformity in the expected operations of the vehicles that occur. simply, you know, if you're trying to take a left turn across this roadway, you know, you're opposing two oncoming lanes, so you have two conflict points. You then have the, you know, ability of cars within a given direction to create some hazards where, you know, weaving across one lane to another causes side swipes. And then the big one is left turns, again, from the four-lane section, where as your driveways on the sides increase and left turns across the roadway increase, a vehicle that sits waiting to turn left, looking for a gap in the oncoming road, one creates a hazard from vehicles coming up from behind them that may have to, you know, slam on the brakes and rear end the vehicle. And also, as the volumes really increase, these inside lanes become de facto left turn lanes anyways, because the only people there are people waiting to turn left. So a three-lane section dramatically reduces the number of conflict points that a roadway has. You come into the left turn lane, you're only opposed by one oncoming lane. There's an expectation of, you know, the only people that are really going to be slowing down within the travel lane are those that are turning right. So the number of conflict points dramatically reduces. It is clearly a much safer configuration, three versus four lanes. And just
the three lane is actually safer than a divided highway than two.
Well, we're talking about an undivided four lane section. I think when we talk about, you know, the divided section along Route 9 that's four lanes, we can certainly talk about that as an alternative. That is going to create some issues in terms of...
Well, that was from one of your red marks at South Maple Street. It is divided on both sides.
It is divided. I think, you know, you have a number of driveways there. You know, it's not a perfect analogy. When you get to a four-lane highway, you know, if you access control it across the left turns, that is one measure to mitigate the safety concerns of a four-lane section. But I think there are other reasons that we can certainly talk about why we are not ultimately recommending that as the alternative through Hadley. Just another quick safety concern is just when you do want to turn left, the four-lane highway has the ability to mask a vehicle in the far lane, so it's simply just, again, another reason to be concerned about safety. We have studies where roads have been taken from four lanes down to three, and these studies indicate a 19% to 47% reduction in crashes, and even more importantly than that, the severity of the crashes drops quite a bit. Vehicle speeds on four-lane roads are quite higher than those three-lane sections. We know speed is the primary contributing factor to severe and fatal accidents. So from a safety standpoint, we clearly have one chip in a three-lane section. So the other component is mobility. While we're going to be safer, how much are we trading off our ability to get down the road in a timely manner? So we undertook that study as well. What you see on this map, the yellow represents travel time in minutes from the Central Rock Gym through Maple Street, the section that we are looking at. You have PM in the westbound direction, Saturday westbound direction, PM in the eastbound direction, Saturday in the eastbound direction. Yellow is the travel time today based on our modeling. We have, you know, sophisticated model that, you know, models driver behavior that is actually, you can sit in real time and watch this thing. But what we do is make sure that the outputs we're getting from the existing model match what actually is occurring in real time, so we calibrate. So these are calibrated existing condition travel times between the Central Rock Gym and Maple Street. And today, you're talking about a 5 minute, 5.5 minute, upwards to 6 minute, you know, travel time on a typical condition. The blue represents a no-build scenario 10 years out. If we do nothing, and we just allow development and growth to occur as it normally does, and look at the properties that are along the stretch of Route 9 that are likely up for development, if they come up online, what that could potentially do to your travel time. And you can see the dramatic spike in delay, which occurs during these time periods. We're talking at least a 100% increase in delay. And in the case of the Saturday conditions, you know, even more exponential delay, going from a 5.5 minute to a 20 minute to 23 minute long commute. So we clearly have something that needs to be addressed. The green represents a four lane section. So we are, if we were to build a four lane cross section, the delay drops down to a condition that's less than we have today. And that is using growth volumes and additional occupancy of the abutting land use. Significant savings. The red is the three-lane section. And again, we are seeing a dramatic decrease back in the delay. back to conditions that are at better or basically within a matter of seconds of the existing travel time. And again, the difference between 3 and 4, and this has been proven out in numerous studies, in capacity is as those volumes increase, the vehicles that are turning left from the inside lane essentially chew up your capacity and make them de facto left turn lanes. So the overwhelming takeaway from the industry is, you know, 3-lane sections like we show carry just as much volume as 4-lane. So
undivided.
We have undivided. So, you know, both of these factors are leading us, the safety is clearly in one side for 3-lane section, and mobility is a wash. They're both about the same, and they're both far better than you're gonna have under a no-build scenario. Which is leading us to recommend that the future section between, along the stretch, be a 3-lane section. Obviously at the signals we have some variability. And I just want to go back as my last slide, and this is our takeaways, to get pretty safer, extreme congestion in the stretch is driven by special events. That's the last point I want to make. You know, I grew up in the area, again, already brought it up, grew up in Agawam. I know when I think about Route 9 and the congestion that occurs, I mean, clearly there is significant congestion that occurs along Route 9. It can be all the way from the Calvin Coolidge Bridge all the way up to University Drive or 116 and back again. When we did our modeling and our traffic data, you know, those travel times of 5 minutes are typical time periods. And I think we got to take somewhat with a grain of salt what's typical along Route 9. The variability of traffic along Route 9 here is not your typical roadway. There are two major factors. One, the university with special events that really have these huge slugs of traffic that come through. And then Saturday, the commercial activity around the malls really spikes. A lot of the you know, surrounding regions come down here for their commercial needs. So that's telling us that, you know, there's something else a bit at play. When we talked about the safety, I wanted to, you know, fall back and see if we could think a little bit deeper about this. And one thing we did take away is the highest day when crashes occur along Route 9 are Fridays. And we dug into it a bit deeper. What type of crashes? Well, rear-end crashes. Rear-end crashes are indicative of like a rolling queue as you just travel along. And lo and behold, 65% of all the rear-end crashes within this 2-lane section are westbound. And 35% of that occur between 3 and 5 p.m. on a Friday. This is the university getting out at the end of the week, and everyone's flying home or trying to get to 91. And the takeaway there is this segment that we're talking about, this is not the driving factor for the congestion that occurs, that extreme congestion I'm sure everyone's aware of. What is driving that extreme congestion is these huge slugs of traffic. It's a traffic management exercise. Conversations with the university about how to control their traffic, that's where really the solution is. The interchange at I-91, which is a project that, you know, I think you're probably aware of, that roundabout, I can tell you, we looked at that, that roundabout will improve Route 9 congestion, there's no doubt about it. And that's gonna be another significant reduction in this capacity. So that being said, what we can control in this project, the 3-lane section for us clearly stands out, and that's the recommendation of the consultants in this exercise that as we go to shovels in the ground for a construction project, that we move forward with a 3-lane cross section and not a 4-lane cross section. So with that, I'm going to hand it back to Mike.
And thanks, Jason.
If we could wrap this up.
So I want to just clarify real quick what that, one of the things Jason didn't say, and I will, is about, is regarding, here, I'll sit back down, I think the light's a little better for those was watching at home, is that divided highways, we think, will limit some of the economic development and growth potential on Route 9. I know the master planning effort is being refreshed, but you know, your existing master plan, and clearly the theme that we have is let's limit commercial development to Route 9 and mostly from here on. So it's a really critical consideration for whether or not we could divide the highway. And we, you know, we felt like by limiting that access, doing that, introducing that kind of access control would really limit the ability for new growth to occur on those otherwise vacant or underutilized, underbuilt, underdeveloped parcels. So that was part of the reason we kind of just threw that out right away. You know, what is down on the other end past Maple Street, but we felt like
it's pretty well constructed now.
Yeah, it's pretty well constructed, but you've got those larger box use. Yeah. You know, you've got the hotels and you've got some restaurants and things that may not discourage, may, you know, the, those uses aren't discouraged by the divider. So anyway.
When you say divided road, are you referring to place like Riverdale in Springfield with the barrier all the
way
down?
Or just
that's
right
what
past,
you're talking
about. Yeah,
that's
about. What I'm saying, like a barrier, a concrete barrier that cuts off access from either side of the road. And you've got to make U-turns or take left turns or whatever you have to do to turn around in direction or to make a left turn into a driveway.
But with the barrier, you're also indicated that it will move more traffic than a three-lane.
I mean,
with
I'm
the divided highway,
I
moves
am indicating
more traffic,
that because
right?
it would. Yeah. But again, this is one of those this is one
making.
Of those goals. Exactly. Yeah. I'm sorry. I was implying that part of what we heard initially, not only from this group but from others in our larger meeting at the high school, is that you know there is something special here that we don't want to damage. So you know, extending that limited access this close all the way, you know, down to somewhere, some point near the center, really isn't consistent with.
You know, the biggest thing today we're confronted with is our commercial district and Amazon. Today everybody's shopping online and less people are going to the malls. And we're considering, you know, protecting our businesses too.
Right.
You know, and that's part
everything,
of the,
you know,
that's why
that's, you know, it's an indirect effect of improving mobility for the corridor. Is getting more people to maybe make that trip rather than buy online. I'll tell you, I can't buy online. Packages get stolen off my stoop. But I live in a very different place than here. And sometimes I wish it were
and
different.
You probably took from the meeting that we don't want this to look like Memorial
exactly.
Drive or
exactly.
Riverdale
yeah.
Road or
precisely.
Whatever. We want it to look still a some
precisely.
Sort of aesthetic to what Hadley
right.
is and.
Right.
You know, your three-lane looked a little bit better than what a four-lane would look
right.
like.
I mean, we all know what these look like. Well, the three-lane cross-section, I don't know that I can think of an example nearby.
No, but you see them
oh,
all over.
Rich, of course. Sorry, Rich, I forgot you were here.
College Highway in Southwick.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We did that project, I think, about 4 or 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we went from two lanes to three lanes with the center two-way left turn lane. And we recently looked at crashes there, and crashes went down almost 50% from the 3 years before construction to the 3 years after construction.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I think that looks, you know, it
decent,
looks
yeah.
pretty nice.
For,
again, what we got was really almost a 50% crash reduction.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think the traffic there is 17,000 cars a day, so it's not as heavy as Route 9, obviously.
Yeah.
But
okay.
it's still fairly heavy traffic.
Still get a lot of the same amount of
that
center
we're
lane
caught
is
in the middle of all this.
Yeah.
We're caught in the middle of all this, you know that.
We do.
You know,
we,
people criticize us, but
yeah.
it's not us that are the driving factors of
this is,
Route 9. So.
Yeah, this is my next question to you. Yeah, because it's fresh in your mind, and you've all said it. You know, we've got Smith College, we've got the city of Northampton, the town of Hadley, the malls, which we've created, the town of Amherst, the University of Massachusetts, and Amherst College. You know, with the budget restraints that we're under right now, we really need to ask and consider a grant for our infrastructure with our water and sewer,
mm-hmm.
where you plan on putting this road. Because it's not just us.
Right. I'm not sure, is there a question there?
Yes, a grant. You missed the grant.
Oh, you're asking for this.
you missed the word grant.
I think there's plenty of funding opportunities from places like MassWorks or things like that that could be we could dovetail and take advantage of together. That was something that Rich and I spoke about probably upwards of a year and a half ago now.
Consideration with the budget restraints around there and the condition of our infrastructure right now, especially along the line.
Right.
So can we, just a question separating maybe fact from fiction.
Sure.
I know a couple of people have suggested to me that the state's motivated to do three lanes versus four lanes due to cost.
No, absolutely not.
So there's limited cost differential between a three-lane solution.
There is a cost differential, but you know, just to be totally clear and honest and transparent about this, we're not the ones, it's not coming out of my pocket, and it doesn't come out of the state's pocket either. This is a decision that's made regionally, and with the respect to you know, what's the best fit? To be totally frank, I think you can ask the design team. When we first set out here, we thought for sure we were building four lanes. The three-lane alternative was originally driven by a need to conduct the environmental impacts report and study under the state environmental review procedure, the NEPA, Massachusetts Environmental Policy Act, which requires us to look at ways to avoid and minimize and mitigate our environmental impacts. So it had that like higher level of review by the state. As we started looking at it, as you know, we started figuring out, and again, like I said earlier, transportation planning and engineering is constantly evolving, and our position has grown, I think, to be a little more flexible, that more lanes aren't better lanes. And in other examples across the state where you have those four lanes, that inside lane becomes the de facto left turn, and safety suffers. And what in a traditional, from a traditional engineering perspective, more lanes are better. You can move more cars. But what we've learned as we've studied this and specifically looked at the conditions here in Hadley, yeah, it is a little cheaper, but we don't think it's the right fit.
Well, and the safety consideration too that comes into play, and I don't know about anybody else, but sometimes just for a game, I mean, just driving down Route 9 where there are four lanes, watching how many people come over that center undivided, they're constantly drifting into
travel
lanes. Yeah, so
that directional component is improved as well.
Mm-hmm. I just want to I'll be remiss if I don't add this, Mike.
Okay, sure.
One of the benefits of a three-lane section as opposed to a four-lane section as the ped bike specialist in the room, and it kind of goes without saying in my world, that it is far, far safer for pedestrians and bicyclists in a three-lane section versus a four-lane section, to the point of a three-lane section could be still an inviting, you know, multimodal corridor where people want to come walk and spend time. As you kind of make that loop to the four-lane, it becomes a more vehicle-dominated environment, speeds go up, and it starts to drive away the use of pedestrians and bicyclists.
And leaves us a bit more room, and leaves us up a lot more room for those facilities, for bike lanes or maybe a side path, which may be a more appropriate. We conservatively showed the painted bike lane here. That's a that's our simplest approach. But I think that there are some other opportunities, especially with that narrower roadway section, that we can maybe design something else instead of that and save, again, try and help reduce speeds, narrow the shoulder, rather than providing the traditional, our minimum 5-foot shoulder. And now Rich is from the district office, and these are the guys who have to approve this, so I might be speaking a little out of turn here. But, you know, we can have a consideration of more refined, you know, right now we're looking at alternatives, this big or this big, three versus four lanes. In the future, as we start designing, essentially from this day on, we really get a design versus this planning and development procedure right now, we can start looking at, can we narrow that shoulder width down, help calm traffic while still allowing for the same number of vehicles to move through, and reallocate that space for maybe a shared use path that acts on, you know, pretty similarly to like something like the rail trail, but just on the side of the road. So you're consolidating a lot of those uses.
Another project in this area where we're doing that separated shared use path is on the Morgan Sullivan Bridge between Agawam and West Springfield, 147, where we're widening the bridge, and we're actually, based on input from Agawam and West Springfield, who want to build better bicycle networks in each of their communities. We're building that separated bike path on the bridge as well, so that there'll be a separated off-road bike path connecting Agawam to West Springfield. And in West Springfield, eventually, they want to carry that all the way on Memorial Ave to Bridge.
Is there anything in the future? I know when they put the park and ride in Deerfield, I said, boy, what a waste of money this is going to be. And I'm amazed at the amount of cars that parked here today. Are there anything in the future for like Amherst and Northampton for park and ride areas?
Not that I'm aware of.
No.
Yeah, not that we've heard of.
Sheldon Field?
Right. Northampton has a park and ride. But you mean, I think he means like across this quarter rather than up and down I-91. So let me just finish up here so that we can, I can just kind of give you guys our overview of where we're at. So right now we've got our mobility study done, our transit mobility study done. we've determined which alternative we think fits best here. We're here to kind of get some feedback from you all and give it that gut check locally. And once, you know, the next step is we initiate this through that MEPA review, the state environmental review. And once that has been certified through the Executive Office of Environmental Affairs, we advance into our more typical design procedure. 25%, go to a more formal public hearing, similar to the public information meeting we conducted at the high school, and then advance into final design and we start construction. Now, that being said, I didn't put any dates on here because we're not quite sure, but right now the region has federal funds programmed in 2020 for a piece of this project. Mm-hmm. I've learned a lot over the years at MassDOT is, I've got nine, Rich, you have what? Some of you won't say, is that this project can get broken up into a couple different pieces depending on what funds are available, and we can, like what we've done along the corridor to out front, is pick up, prioritize which ones are most important, maybe really tackling East Street and the safety issues at Maple, and then tying that together with another phase that fully addresses the corridor width, something like that, all depending on the readiness of our design. So we're working on from one end to the other, getting the whole thing getting the whole thing designed, and as funds are available, as they are now in 2020, that's when we can start construction. And like I say, over the years you learn stuff gets funded because it's ready sometimes, but also because it's a priority. So we're trying to hit both. The roundabout over in Northampton is right now one of the higher priorities for this corner of the region, and clearly for the Route 9 corridor and its mobility as a whole. What we've heard from a lot of folks is, don't worry about all that, fix that first. So, you know, that's something that I think MassDOT is taking very seriously and recognizes. There's a big problem there, and it needs to be addressed first.
We assume that roundabout's going to be a lot more like our friends in Agawam on 57 than what we've been putting in with the smaller units, right?
It would be a small diameter roundabout, not like Agawam, which has a rotary that was kind of retrofitted to operate a bit like
or Greenfield.
This will be more like Greenfield. I mean, if the
91.
No,
Northampton Look Park.
No, I was thinking
it's going to be like Look Park.
Like the one near GCC in Greenfield.
This would be more like Look Park. But it'll be two lanes.
Is Look Park one?
Actually have some.
Yes.
A lot more capacity in this one.
If you're actually interested in that, I have.
I'm not going to.
There'll be an opportunity for talk on that, right? Other than.
But that's a one. So that's a one lane. That's far small. So the one lane roundabout and the two lane roundabout, while they sound like very similar, they operate very differently in terms of how many vehicles they can move. A one lane roundabout, really its intent is to slow cars down and maybe not increase congestion, but make it a little smoother for each leg of that intersection to get in and get out, which does induce a bit of queuing. In this case, this roundabout will favor the Route 9 movement because it's one of the heavier movements that will process that traffic fairly well, certainly a lot better than substantially better than what we have there today.
But no lights will be there?
There will not be signals.
So how are you going to come off of Damon Road and
get
back this way?
Have you ever driven in Europe?
No.
They have roundabouts
so
everywhere.
So Damon Road, it's all about, like we said, you guys heard earlier from David, it's all about balancing. And I think we've
keeping everything moving instead
we're
of
doing,
things coming
yeah,
to a hard
exactly.
stop and going.
So Damon Road, obviously, we all know, I'm not going to hide from it. It's a big issue. But, you know, when I was standing there earlier this evening just to kind of watch how that was operating, it was very clear that the larger, the heavier movement is Route 9. And there was probably...
It's a heavier movement, but then when you're on Damon Road trying to get back home here...
It's all a matter of perspective, right?
It's right. And you're
Let me guess, you come home on Damon Road.
I do. But not only that, but you have the bike light, which really ties up traffic there on Damon
but
Road.
But they're not
that,
here to talk about the roundabout.
I know.
We actually aren't,
saying.
So thank you. But I'm happy to entertain the discussion. It's just, you know, it is there's... Designing a transportation project, I'll tell you, it's never simple.
I'm skeptic.
Okay. All comments should be forwarded to Richard Mass, District 2.
But Route 9 is more interested in that it stays aesthetic. I'm more worried about our small businesses that are from here to East Street, that they're concerned about when the timing of the project is going to be, because their business has been really shot this summer.
Right.
And I want to know what you're going to do to help that for the next phase of this and give them some timeline and, you know, certainly keep it.
Those
touch,
sorts of details will definitely come out as we get into design. Like I said,
what's that guy's name again? Rick Massey.
Rich Massey. So,
we got some questions about Bay Road Bridge.
That's true. So I will turn it over to him in just once. I think this is all I've got. We've got
that
a website.
Part's not tonight.
No.
We've got a website. I'm going to post that transit route map. I checked. It was not. We don't have it posted yet. Okay. We do have the presentation to the stakeholder group, which is actually a little more comprehensive. It's the same, pretty much the same presentation you saw tonight.
Yep.
So if you just Google Route 9 Corridor Improvement Project, it's the first website that shows up. And this slide you can grab off that presentation. Yeah, as I said earlier, I'm Michael. That's Nate over in the corner. He's taking notes for us, minutes get produced. We post those. And if you're interested in staying involved, like for when we do our next big public information meeting, we would email you. And that's really, that was it.
Okay.
So if we could have the lights. I'll just say, in terms of timing and how we deal with that, that's in construction, those are things we'll definitely start to specify out as we get further along in the design process. And on that timeline I showed you, the 25%, 100%. 100% is really where we've figured out how the thing gets built, and you know, whether there's phases or stages or whatever word we use. We figure that out much later once the project's engineered. This is really us making that big step forward, that leap past the planning milestone into development, where we said, okay, we think three lanes is the right course of action. This is our preferred alternative. We're going to advance that into environmental review.
Okay. 25 years, opposed, excuse me.
I was just going to say, I mean, we've allotted, it's been a full hour at this point.
Yeah,
in
I
our
know.
Meeting,
I'm terribly sorry.
Well, it's critically important to the town, but I'm just thinking, I think we're going to have, you know, ongoing conversations, so I'm hoping we can wrap it up because we still have a fairly full agenda ahead of us this evening.
Right.
Just
so,
one
sure,
quick question. 25 years ago when we did the bridge and four lanes to West Street, that was designated as a corridor of critical concern. Does this have that same tag for these next two sections as that did?
I am not aware of that designation, no.
Is there any way that could be designated as they did the bridge?
You mean in terms of to,
of importance
increase.
To get the project done in the area?
Yeah,
that's why they designated the bridge in that as a
I'm
quarter
not sure
of critical
that PVPC
concern.
Uses terms like that anymore. So this
no.
is really all about the region and how they program their federal funds.
And in the meantime, the feds are supposed to be releasing a lot of money for roads and bridges. So the more you have 100%, just as you said, of these projects ready to go, there's a better chance.
Shovel
that,
ready.
Oh, yeah,
there's a much better chance. And we are
keenly ready to fund that immediately. You know?
This team is keenly aware of that.
I
so Rich has to manage his district.
You guys went from about 40% to 90% right now. In my mind, you really got it together.
Yeah, I'll
really
tell you, it's been hard for especially John, who has sat very quietly and patiently in the corner as Jason and I get to do, and Carolyn get to do all the talking. This is our civil engineer.
I'm not sure what the pie chart on that would look like.
He's our civil engineer, and he's dying to get going. So, you know, the reins are off for him. When the next time you guys see us, we'll have black and white drawings.
And I'd just like to thank you for those stakeholder meetings. They're so informative, and it brings everybody in the loop in the five college area.
Well, thank you for saying that.
You know, and
we find it
very, very
too.
Beneficial.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, all right, we will get out
you.
Of the way. I hope to be home before you guys are.
Yeah,
I've got 2 hours.
Point, yeah.
I'll check when I get
home.
Well,
we do have Rich here, and we do need to
yes.
know
yeah,
an
that's
update
true.
On
that's
Bay
true.
Road before.
Right.
Where are we? You sat in front of us. We're
right.
we're really in trouble here. You know, we told everybody this was going to be done by the fall, and 18 conversations later, we haven't done anything. please help us.
All right, we do have the sign for the repairs completed. We do need to repair all of the piles in the riverbed, which is 5 of the 7 piers. And some of them will be completely repaired, being coated with a basically a fiberglass shell that will be filled with reinforced concrete. And some of the existing piles have already been repaired in the past, maybe about 30 years ago. And those repairs actually need to be extended up to two or more feet below where they extend and above that. So we have the design. We'll be moving into getting the permits now. There will be water control needed. They'll have to dewater to get down to those levels that they need to get the deterioration that's below the mud line.
Summer for that.
And we will be working on those permits very soon. I don't think we need an order condition from the Conservation Commission. It's bridge exempt, but we do need a water quality certificate from the DEP. So we'll be working through that permitting and getting into construction. We also need, the estimated cost will be around $1 million. And
is this going to be a temporary fix, or?
This is an interim fix until the bridge is completely replaced in a future year, probably 4 or 5 years from now at least.
Are you going to put a box culvert in, or are you going to put a bridge back in? Or you
it'll be a bridge, and actually I think it'll be a three-span bridge. It'll still have a pier on each side at the edge of the riverbank, but the river itself will be a clear span.
When?
And that's the bridge repairs. Conservatively right
that's
now.
That's a camera, you know.
Conservatively right now, we're saying, you know, 3 months that it'll take to construct it, and we don't have the permit yet.
Okay.
So I'm also an environmental planner, so I can vouch for.
Hang on, he ain't done yet.
Yeah.
So you've perceived this to be this year. We're not going to talk about budgets aren't available and that. You think this is still going to happen this year?
At this point, I still believe it will happen this year. The money, in fact, is not set aside. We need to add money to a contract to do that. I can't approve that locally. That has to go to Boston. But we're going to get that. We expect to get that done. And again, it's $1 million fix to carry the bridge over. And it's actually going to be two phases where we'll have to do the piers under the part of the bridge that's closed first in stage one, going down to the river from the southeast side of the bridge. And then when those are complete, we'll shift the traffic onto that part of the bridge on the other side of the barriers and go down on the other side and do the upstream ones after that. So it'll be a two-phase project. And
the bridge is closed down.
No, it's open to one-lane alternating traffic and posted it.
It'll be great.
And we don't want trucks, plow trucks with sand on the back driving over it and having every pedestrian that's getting tickets on it telling us that we're violating the whole thing that's going on there. So we need your help on this one. We went to those people. We told them it would be done this summer.
And we need to contact the legislators on the funding side.
That's been done.
But I keep the pressure on because they don't have it yet. Okay, well, thank you.
Well, we haven't
thank
submitted it yet because we just got the design
on
which to base the cost estimate.
Right.
So,
timing is everything.
And in your considerations, that's going to be a major bypass for your next section of Route 9. I really wish you guys would consider that Bay Road Bridge more important than Route 9 at this point, because you're going to need that to divert that traffic.
So the funding is two set. Sorry, Rich.
Yeah, I know it is, but you're saying 5 years, and we're talking about 4 years down the road. They're going to.
That's for the full replacement.
They're going to work right into each other.
With these repairs that are made, we can't re-rate the bridge until the repairs are done.
Yeah.
But we do hope and expect that when those are done, that it can be rated to carry truckloads again.
In ballpark, we're looking 18 over here and then 20 for over here. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I didn't follow that.
2018.
The biggest thing with that bridge that bothers me is ambulance service.
Project is to be advertised.
There's no way that can be amended to let ambulances over there. Granby and Belchertown, and that's 30 minutes to that runs.
Okay, I know everybody's excited because we have Rich in front of us, but we'll call you back again, because you're just a rock star.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, everybody. We really need to move on with this meeting.
Okay, thank you for your
thank
time
you
so
much.
Much.
Everybody. Thank you.
Have a great night, guys.
Okay, take care.
I hope you get some sleep.
Thanks.
Good night. Appreciate it.
What's sleep? Okay, Tree Warden. This should be quick, right? DPW
yes.
Director. Procedure for tree work.
Well, as we all know, our tree warden is retiring.
Yep.
And I wanted to come before the board, and at some point, we want to take a look at tree warden, its duties, qualifications. Obviously, they haven't been updated in a long, long time here. Things have changed over the years. So I just come before the board to see if we it would be possible to get an alternate in place until we can.
Do you have a recommendation?
I don't mind doing it between now and when we figure out where we want to go with it, how we want to go with it, if it pleases the board.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on that?
Is there nobody else in the department so we can free you up, and or you think this is the best?
I think for the time span, it will be fine for him,
as
it's part of the reorganization we talked about, and again, qualifications and what the Tree Wardens Association requires or would like to see in a tree warden in today's world is much different. So,
David, do you have something to say?
Marlon and I have talked about what that might look like for the FY 2018 budget, which is going to start. We're going to start working on that in the next 30 days. So. Getting the alternate in place right now, I think, is very important. But where this position ultimately ends up, we'll look at that.
Sure.
I mean, usually the way it works is a tree warden, regardless if they're appointed from the public or they're within the DPW, they work under the jurisdiction of the Director of Public Works normally, not all the time, but normally, because the funding's there for the director to handle. So that's why we got to look at how we want to do that all going forward. Because like I said, the requirements are much different today.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Do you have,
all right. Congratulations, Mr. Tree Warden.
Have you done this in Greenfield?
Well, looking at the qualifications going forward, it's not mandatory for a community under a population of 10,000 to have a certified arborist. That would be the things we need to talk about going forward. What's mandatory and what's not? It's very pretty clear, but population under 10,000, the requirements are much less than a larger city.
Okay. Thanks, Marlo. Water abatement for 108 East Street we have next. Do we need to, is this important?
Well, we're talking about trees. I just don't want to jump over this. Something I asked 3 months ago, and no one's ever brought it back about cutting off the reservoir. We haven't got any new information about that, and there's a great deal of revenue sitting there.
Where's the action item left? I remember the vote, and we agreed to pursue that.
We agreed to study it and find out and get back. We're going to hire a forester to look at it and bring an estimate back to us, and nothing has transpired with it.
So where we left this off is we were going to have somebody informally look at those at that lumber. We had asked Janice Stone at the Conservation Commission to take a look at it, particularly since they're developing the open space preservation plan. And so there are elements left over in the old open space preservation plan which have not been addressed, one of which would be an inventory of the forest. So this is a much bigger problem than just looking at revenue from one particular site.
Mm-hmm.
We've looked at this informally. It doesn't look like the timber there is very valuable. So we can continue working on this, but my recommendation is wait for the open space plan to be updated and conservation's working on that.
Okay.
Fine.
All right, so we also have on the agenda this evening a water abatement at 108 East Street. This is a reconsideration of the water abatement decided on August 17th.
Gail and Susan Sigmont are here appealing the decision made by the select board on the August 17th meeting.
Okay, and I assume that was a no abatement was offered.
That was a no abatement was offered.
Okay. Do you have additional information?
Well, I'm not sure. From what I understand, the charge per gallon for the first, is it 1,000 gallons?
999.
Whatever, is that one rate and then it goes up? And you were just wondering if there would be any consideration for not increasing it beyond that for this particular instance, because we did have what was deemed a silent leak and didn't know we had a problem until it was far too late. And ended up with a bill of $2,100 plus, which was an incredible hardship for us. And so I guess, you know, when I was here at the last meeting, it wasn't what I expected, but I didn't have the knowledge of how these things work. But when we did get the notice in the mail, it did give us the option to appeal, and so that's why we're here, in the hopes that anything that could be done would be appreciated.
Yeah, so I think the problem that we ran into last time was the fact that, you know, unfortunately we've had these silent leaks before. I mean, it happens. And the question always from the, typically the way that we've reacted to it is whether or not the water actually made its way through the system.
I understand that, yes.
So you're just questioning now whether or not the calculation of the... I'm just not quite
why
sure.
Why it goes up after a certain amount?
In an effort to conserve water, we set it up as a system so that the more water you use, the actual more you pay.
Understood.
And that's why it's set up that way.
Right.
We lived in this house for 47 years of our life, and the last year we've been taking care of our mom. We didn't know.
We didn't have anything to do with any of this.
No.
And, you know,
we finally had to put her in a nursing home, but we've been, you know, we just had no clue that we had a leak.
The most unfortunate thing for us is we sit up here, and I understand it's hard for you to sit there and say you got a $2,000 bill. The problem is that these things occur all the time, and it happens to people, and then everybody walks in the door and says, geez, I had a leak, and I really don't want to pay for my water.
Understood it. Just, you know, you were offered an appeal, so that's why we're here.
And we were encouraged to pursue it. We were encouraged by the office. We went there to,
and I said, am I wasting my time, or should we appeal? We're told you should appeal. Mm-hmm. So that's why we're here.
Yeah, I mean, the 10 cycle billing periods clearly show they didn't use that type of water in the last.
I don't think they're questioning whether or not they had a leak or not.
5 years, yeah.
Right. We've never had anything like this happen in 47 years, ever.
I'm just looking, I don't see where the calculation's going.
So the calculation, there's the lifeline, a baseline, and a conservation. The lifeline was 225 as a low water use. And Marlo, please correct me if I say anything wrong. The baseline is 3.45,
mm-hmm.
and the conservation is 4.85.
Okay. And the $2,000 is being calculated at the highest rate of 485?
You calculate the first 999
Oh, so it's a graduated, okay.
Yeah.
You increase exponentially from there.
It's a tiered system, so
yeah.
It's set up, you know, as Mr.
Jerry
Gorin said,
yeah.
It was set up in order to encourage conservation of water.
What does it figure out to be at the lower rate?
Is there a history of abating the rates on these? I don't think they've ever done it.
There is none.
Have you talked about entering into a payment plan? I mean, I know that's
we
something.
We paid it.
It's paid.
That's already paid.
We've never paid. You know, we always paid on time. We've never.
It's paid. We appreciate it. And we understand where you're coming from.
We're just hoping that, you know, this time something could be done.
Yeah. Just since Jerry said the problem is we're setting a precedent for.
Well, only because other people have come in and asked for the
same
thing.
Right, but they did the appeal. I mean, why would we be encouraged to appeal it?
Who encouraged you to appeal?
We wouldn't pay the bill.
Who?
Someone in the office.
The collector's
what
office?
Office.
Collector's office.
And she did the same to you, too. She encouraged you.
I was contacted by Ms. Zygmunt, who asked about the appeal process. I said that there were basically two avenues open. There was an appeal to basically by taking it to court,
mm-hmm.
which didn't seem to be in the best interest of anybody.
No.
And I said it has been done in the past that the select board has reconsidered an abatement request, and that an informal process would probably be better because it doesn't incur costs to either side regardless of the outcome.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I was asking. What's the total at the lower rate?
I don't have the total at the lower rate. I have it broken down.
So So
I think
we've calculated out what an abatement.
Do you know what it is?
So the sewer is a flat rate of 460, so that's 1081. That's a flat rate for everybody. If you did it at the baseline rate, it would be I'm sorry, I want to say this correctly. If you went to the base rate, the baseline, it would be $831.26. That's including the access fee of $32.50.
That's on the water.
That's on the water. The
right.
Sewer is a flat rate.
Yeah,
and
sure,
and they didn't, I have no way to do that. It's just a flat rate across the board.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you wouldn't know that.
Yeah, I knew there was two rates for the water.
My concern, again, is just consistency. And if again, we're not trying to mean to be ogres, it's just if we do this once, then from this point forward, we would have a lot of difficulty telling anybody that they couldn't have the same.
How many people you actually put in?
Lots of them, John.
How many people appeal? Come back.
Nobody.
So,
we're
anybody
right.
Interested.
Exactly. That's why we're here.
In a way, couldn't we treat this as a hardship also, and that would be a separate case? Because the mother had to go into the nursing home and they weren't aware of the situation. And it's not a precedenting situation like all the others, because it would be a hardship case.
That makes sense.
I would make a motion to reduce to that rate and view it as a hardship case. I don't know if there's a second or not, but I'll make the initial motion.
I can't second it, but that's why I asked what the lower rate would be. That's time.
Just on the water?
Just on the water.
So DPW cannot make the recommendation because they have to follow the water regulations.
Correct.
So it's completely up to the select board's
right.
Mm-hmm. Pleasure.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody want to second Donald's motion?
I'll second that for discussion.
Okay. Discussion?
If we did reduce it to that amount, it would be 831 would be the bill, so there would be a
$200 savings.
$200 refund. That was just what, I'm just adding that as to.
Oh, you're just giving more information.
More
okay.
information
okay.
on how much it would be.
All right. So put it to a vote then. All in favor of granting the abatement? Aye.
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 Opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Motion fails.
So
motion fails.
Fails.
Okay. Sorry.
Good old sloppy man.
Okay. So next would be the public safety complex roof. David, is that you?
All right. So we received 7 bids for the public safety complex roof. They were opened on August 29th. The apparent low bidder is Supreme Systems at $225,000 even. The available budget for this project is $205,000. There is a municipal repair fund that could also augment this project. The balance in there is about $92,000. The Municipal Building Committee has earmarked $47,000 of that for other projects. I would leave a balance of about $45,000 that could be applied to this particular project if you chose to. So my recommendation after reviewing all the bids is, and checking the references and the paperwork, is to award project to Supreme Systems with two contingencies. One is the transfer of $31,250 from the municipal repair account. That would provide you with a shortfall plus a 5% contingency of $11,250. That's contingency number one. Contingency number two would be the receipt of a valid sheet metal license, which is a requirement for working in the state of Massachusetts on this project. We're in contact with Supreme Systems, and we don't have that information for tonight. But just to keep everything moving along, that's my recommendation.
They don't have a sheet metal license?
I have not been able to get that information from them yet. I'm not saying they have it or don't have it.
Okay.
Okay, so your recommendation is we keep moving with Supreme?
And just as a little bit of background, this is the second time we did that project. We redesigned the project, and we, you know, I don't think we're going to get a better price at this point.
Okay.
So.
Motion second on that?
I second it, and let's add one more stipulation to it, to your stipulation, that it gets done this year.
Yes, the contract has them doing this whole project in 90 days.
Okay.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, RFP Town Center Land.
We received two responses from our RFP for land at the center of Hadley. We received no responses for our RFP for land in the north end of Hadley. So the two proposals for Center Village were evaluated. There were some questions remaining that prevented us from moving forward with this project. We asked for clarification on both of them. We received the clarification information. We then ranked the two responses in order of responsiveness to the RFP, and then we opened up the price proposals, and the prices are, I believe, in front of you. The first one is for 1 3/4 acres, and I think the price off the top of my head is
$787,500.
Thank you. And the other one was a lot next to it, 3 acres in size, for $1.4 million and change. Works out to a price of $475 per acre for the 3 acre lot, and I think it's $450 per acre for the 1.75 acre lot. So I would recommend taking this under advisement and forwarding this on to the Capital Planning Committee.
Excellent idea. Everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
Before I open my mouth, yeah.
Okay. We did have under old business a placeholder for the police, but the police chief has requested that we delay discussion of this. This was from last week's meeting, and we invited him back in.
To the 21st?
To the meeting on the 21st, and he's getting more information together for us. Okay. So we have two items remaining, special town meeting warrant review, and then select board meeting schedule. So the warrant review, are there critical discussion points tonight?
I think the things that we can deal with tonight is, first of all, is to again state that the three petition articles were certified by the town clerk. I received that information this afternoon. So they are on the warrant, and they will be presented to the voters. The other is we weren't quite sure how many articles were going to be presented by the Municipal Building Committee. I don't have an update on that. It sounded like there were two articles, not the five as originally proposed.
Mm-hmm. But you haven't officially heard from them?
I haven't heard anything.
Okay.
They
did meet last night. Yeah. Jerry, do you have an update?
I haven't got my update on it yet.
Yep. Not an official one.
I think they were truly waiting just to see if there was going to be one more with information from the opening of the.
Right.
But I think there'll be three at a maximum.
All right,
so we should plan on the 21st then, committing a fair amount of time to this.
Right.
Is that? Yeah. Okay, does anybody have anything on the warrant? And then also too, we heard tonight, there was a request from the Council on Aging regarding warrant article placement.
They're happy with eight though, right?
She said that, yes, yep. Okay.
The only question I have is how the positions changed. Originally, the North Hadley Fire Station was number four, now it's number nine, and the Senior Center is number eight. How was that decided and when?
There were two North Hadley's Fire Station articles. One is a petition article, which I believe is number nine, and then there's an article that was submitted in a non-petition format, which I believe is article seven.
Seven.
Typically, when we have a submitted article and a petitioned article, we pair them together so that we can accomplish what is in the most efficient manner of the business. Typically, we act on one and then pass over the other. And this is usually done if there's some sort of flaw with one article or another that can't be corrected.
After the 19th, there may not even be a need for some of these articles also. We don't know that at this point.
Well, the petitioned articles are going to be on.
Regardless, you are.
Okay, so we'll take this back up then on the 21st. Select board meeting schedule. So it looks like, okay, well, we know we're meeting tonight, and then we have the forum on the 13th and a scheduled meeting on the 21st. And then the suggested dates are the, basically, I think it's every
so we are
every
meeting,
week in October.
So we are meeting on the 14th,
it's Thursday, so I thought we changed that date.
We did.
It's
not next week.
The 13th, Tuesday now.
Tuesday.
From 14th to the 13th, yeah.
No.
Okay. So we would skip the 28th of September. Okay. And then we have all special town meeting all the time in the month of October. And then we take a break for the first week of November after the special town meeting.
We're doing every Wednesday in October.
I think we're putting it on as a placeholder. If we can skip a meeting, I'm more than happy to.
Do we all have to come in costume?
Logically, it would be the 19th, I would think. Sure.
Well, you're going to have one on the 5th every week?
Schedule it.
Yeah.
Placeholder.
Yeah. We're scheduling it in preparation for a special town meeting, but if there's no need, obviously, we can always cancel
one. We can
one.
Adjust it. Let's set it up like that now.
Okay. And then we've got two in November and two in December. Is everybody okay with these?
Makes
for now?
Sense.
Okay.
And would you say the dates were in November?
November 9th and 16th. And then December 7th and 14th.
Okay. 21st? Is there one on the 28th? I didn't hear you.
No, not on the 28th,
okay.
Just the 21st.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so announcements?
I have none.
David?
Tomorrow is voting day for the state primary. Make sure that you exercise your right to vote. Polls open at 7, close at 8 for Hawkins Academy.
I think Susan already did a great job, but this weekend, Eddie Foreman's over at the Senior Center.
Mm-hmm.
And chicken to go at the Legion.
Right.
Are there any tickets left available?
I don't know.
They said this morning there was
yeah.
At the staff meeting. At the Legion, though. They are.
Okay. You have an announcement?
Yeah. There's a tentative retirement date for Mike Komoski at the Young Men's Club. It'll be on October 7th, on Friday.
Isn't that Columbus Weekend?
What?
That's
yes.
Columbus Weekend, isn't it?
Yeah. The club, the pavilion is shut down right after that.
Right. You said it's Friday night.
Right. You afraid you're going to lose a lot of people, though, who might be going away for the weekend, Jeff?
Well, I mean, could be.
Tickets available or anything like that? How do people?
Well, we're just making all that stuff up right now.
Okay.
Okay.
Can you get some to DPW and to the board here?
Yeah. We can get that all set.
And when you say give, that means make them available.
Yes.
Yeah. So we can sell them.
Josh, you wanna drop them off?
Okay. All right, no other announcements then? So we do have two executive sessions scheduled this evening.
I'll make a motion. The select board is scheduled, oh yeah, we go into executive session, oh yeah. For the provision of MGL Chapter 38, Section 21A, 1, to discuss the reputation, character, physical condition, or mental health, rather than professional competence of an individual, or to discuss the discipline or dismissal of or complaints or charges brought against a public officer, employee, staff member, or individual. And we will not reconvene in open session.
And you have to say.
Oh, yay.
So that's Hadley Public Access Television and the select board.
Okay.
Okay. And as chair, I declare that having this discussion in open session would have a detrimental impact to the town of Hadley.
Roll call vote, Ms. Gibbons.
Yes.
Devine.
Yes.
Keegan.
Yes.
Trungla.
Yes.
Kaczynski.
Yes.
Okay. Good night, everybody. Thank you.